93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Is the eye of the tiger needed for today's show? We move from the 70s to the 80s with the opening theme. I may see if I can get a consultant's gig with this place, because Lord knows I don't have enough paychecks. Like, director of musical operations for The Fan might be the way that I would go. My name is Greg Rakestraw. I am back with you for a second day. For some, there is much rejoicing. For others, probably the clicking of radios, if you still, for some reason, change your dial without the benefit of some sort of push-button technology. Yesterday was the all-coaches edition of the show. Today, we have one coach on the program, that being the head coach of the Indy 11 in Mark Lowry. You knew if they gave me 6 hours of radio over the course of 2 days, I'd get at least 10 to 15 minutes of soccer conversation on the program. Knowing I get an hour of soccer talk tomorrow, you know, you've heard the liner before. If this is your football, then this is your show. Soccer Saturday. Hello, that's me. We're about to hit like 400 episodes of that program, by the way. Actually, maybe we're like to 500 episodes. I've lost track. We're literally starting like year number 10 of that program coming up in like a month, because the 10th season of the Indy 11 rolls around. Well, in all of 2 weeks, head coach Mark Lowry in the 2 o'clock hour of the program. But before that, well, non-coaches, a lot of broadcasters, and a couple of current athletes on the docket for today's show as well. Brandon Gaudin will be our first guest of the day. He will join us at 12:30. Of course, Brandon spent a few years as the radio voice of the Butler Bulldogs, has been the voice of Madden. You have heard him. You have seen him on Fox, on Big Ten Network, college basketball, college football, National Football League games. And, well, he and I were the two broadcasters for the Colts and Lions preseason game that took place in week number 2 of the preseason back in August. Brandon's docket's going to be pretty busy, and I'm sure with spring training coming around, that starts sooner rather than later. He is the brand new voice of the Atlanta Braves on TV. I think Fox Sports South, I think, is where you find them, or Bally Sports South or something along those lines. Anyway, Brandon will be joining us coming up in the next segment of the show. Jeremiah Johnson will check in after an epic Pacers-Celtics game last night that, according to some of you, went well for the Indiana Pacers. And listen, I'm not going to criticize the Pacers at all for their effort last night. The Celtics are a hell of a basketball team, maybe the best team in the entire NBA, and clearly from a record standpoint, they are the best team in the Eastern Conference. Pacers put up 138 on them. Only problem is that the Pacers gave up 142. Miles Turner was fantastic, but again, we kind of scratched the surface on this discussion yesterday. Are you on team playoffs or team tank? If you're of the latter, last night was absolutely perfect for you. And I saw a lot of tweets fly by on my timeline that was the desired result. Again, to me, losing, I wouldn't say is a benefit. That gives the wrong connotation. I want to see this team win. I want to see this team pull those games out. So I'm not being critical of last night. Just, I want to see them be a playoff team. I like the young pieces in place. You are in a position from both a cap space and a draft pick standpoint that more talent is coming in here in the offseason regardless. I don't think Victor Wembanyama, am I saying his name right, by the way? The 7'5" French kid, I think is how most people, you know, refer to him. But I believe that's how you say his last name. I doubt he's coming here. We did this yesterday on the program. The history of the Pacers moving up in the draft lottery, well, it's like never stinking happened. So maybe you say they're due. I want to see them win. Played great last night. Now, against a team of similar ilk, when the Magic are the opponent on Saturday, I think the last time the Magic kind of beat up the Indiana Pacers when they played, I want to see the Pacers get a win. Because the Magic, you know, are in the tank, and they have been for a long time. I don't want to see the Pacers be that bunch. So Pacers lose last night, but entertaining loss, and Miles Turner was spectacular last night for the Indiana Pacers. And I know that is always a lightning rod of conversation, maybe less so now that we know what his more immediate future is going to be, that he's under contract for two more years with this team. We'll have Pacers conversation with Jeremiah Johnson before he hits the team plane to head to Central Florida. JJ joins us later on this hour. In the 1 o'clock hour of the show, you know, normally in February, we don't talk to that many members of the Indianapolis Colts. This is the time of year of a current player scenario. January, February, March is when those guys kind of scatter to the four winds. Well, Kylen Granson, and I kind of got wind of Kylen's charitable efforts before I ever played it down for the Indianapolis Colts. Like, there was talk about, like, this book drive or school supply initiative that Kylen had put together, like, after he was drafted. Like, I saw this PR release from not the team PR, but from, like, his own personal PR person. Well, he has a book drive that starts next weekend, and he is hoping to raise 10,000 books. KG's Kids, KGSKids.com, is where you can find out more information and hopefully donate. We'll certainly let him plug that when he joins us approximately an hour from now. But then we'll also ask him thoughts on Shane Steichen, thoughts on potentially drafting a new quarterback. And obviously, Kylen is a bit partial. You would think that guys in the locker room are partial to their current teammates. Got to remember, he was a high school teammate of Sam Ellinger. So we'll kind of navigate those waters with Kylen coming up in a little bit. The progress he hopes to make from year two to year three. And knowing that the pieces are going to change, they always do. But knowing free agency is coming up and knowing the position the Indianapolis Colts have in the draft, the way that locker room looked last year, he is going to look very different this time around. We'll get his thought on that. Again, that is coming up in the opening segment of the 1 o'clock hour of the show. And our other guest that will be gracing our airwaves between now and 3 o'clock would be Antoine Davis. His Detroit Mercy team lost last night. Antoine had 27 points. And if I have done the math properly, that now puts him within 100 points of Pistol Pete Maravich with a guarantee of two games left to go. If he wins in the conference tournament, which they would play next Tuesday, and I will rifle through those scenarios, if not on the air, then over the course of a break, could potentially get a third game. You simply do the math. Okay, he's averaging right around 27 points a game. So what he had last night, kind of on par with his season average. So he probably needs four games, can get it done in three if he can get to Pistol Pete. And we'll talk to Antoine coming up. They have their regular season finale tomorrow. We'll talk to Antoine Davis coming up in the 1 o'clock hour of the show. So a little more room for you and I to interact today than we had a day ago. The phone line is open. In fact, it's open right now. 317-239-1070. Interact with me on Twitter, at Greg Rakestraw. Email the program to greg@1070thefan.com. What you will not notice on those five guests that I rattled off is someone to talk Purdue and Indiana. And I figured we could do that. Maybe the spirit might move me. I might track somebody down to add into the guest mix to talk about that game. And let me talk out of both sides of my mouth here. Okay? We do that a little bit in this business. This is, from a rankings interest standpoint, as big as this game has been in a long time. Now, maybe you could say the bigger game was 3 weeks ago when Purdue was riding a bit higher than they are right now. And even Indiana, to some degree, was kind of that way too. But it was the number one team going into Bloomington. And for as good as the freshmen have been in terms of Braden Smith, Fletcher Lawyer, to go along with the unstoppable force that is Zach Edey, you could tell that Lawyer and Smith had never been a part of anything like that day in Assembly Hall before. And Purdue played better in the second half, could not climb out of the hole that was dug in the first half with how well Indiana played. the emotional lift that that tremendous crowd at Assembly Hall gave them, which is to a certain degree what will happen tomorrow for Purdue in terms of being at Mackey. But again, the reason that I'm not full guns a-blazing and crazy fired up for Purdue and Indiana tomorrow, again, while it's on, it's great. But I've got a handle on these teams at this point. And this is the case in college basketball, period. We are 27, 28 games into the season. You're allowed to play 30 or 31 during the course of the regular season at the Division I level. Then we'll have conference tournaments. But it's just kind of the nature of the major conference level of Division I hoops. And it's the dichotomy, it's the difference from the coaches we had on yesterday to the topic that I'm opening the show with to talk about today. Like at the end of the season, at the end of the regular season, this last week in February, ending of the first week in March, to me, for this 7 to 10 day window, like I'm more interested in Indiana State because everything they have done this season will come down to next Friday, Saturday, and Sunday in Arch Madness in St. Louis. Ball State's conference tournament is a week later. It's been a wonderful first year for Michael Lewis in Muncie. But how his season is remembered is going to come down to what that team does for 3 days in Cleveland the following week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. For Indiana, their season will likely not be determined by what happens in tomorrow's game. For Purdue, they will hear about it for the remainder of the offseason if Indiana sweeps them, because that's what rivalries are about. That's what you're supposed to do. But I still think what Purdue's season will be remembered for isn't going to happen this week, isn't going to happen next week. Even if Purdue, and it certainly appears they're going to, even if Purdue wins the outright Big Ten championship, that's great. But Matt Painter's teams have done that on a semi-regular basis. Such is the price of success. You get to a certain level, and fans, media, etc., then ask, well, why haven't you done more? So the questions that we want to ask, the mileposts that we want to see these programs get to and surpass on February the 25th. They're on March 25th or past March 25th. By the way, if you don't have your calendar memorized, March 25th would be two of the four games in the Elite Eight to see who goes to the Final Four. That's part of the reason why I use those dates. So the atmosphere of Mackey tomorrow is going to be phenomenal. The fact that Indiana and Purdue are both in the top 20, are both in the top four seeds when the NCAA tournament folks revealed the brackets last week, that's tremendous. I'm not telling you not watch tomorrow's game or care about tomorrow's game. It's going to be great. But everything in terms of what really piques my interest and gets my appetite for those two teams going, it's more along the lines of, hey, this one's going to be good. Get through next week. Big Ten tournament, okay, whatever, fine. I know it'd be nice for Indiana to make a run of the Big Ten tournament because, well, you know, it's like never happens that, you know, for them. That's what's going to happen in March. Is Indiana a second week team? And then once they get there, how do they match up? Can they get past that Sweet 16? Because, let's face it, when we talk about Indiana, we don't talk about, hey, you see that Sweet 16 banner? We talk about five banners, right? We have debates over the back of the day those banners used to sway. Martha the Mop Lady, I had to verify that. I had to, you know, I backed her up. Said, yeah, those banners used to move. The scoreboards did too on Twitter earlier this week. So I get that, you know, the rallying cry for an Indiana Hoosier fan. Let's get to the second weekend. Yeah, that doesn't sound as sexy as you want it to, right? But you also have to acknowledge where you've been and not make. You know, last year's milepost was making the tournament and winning that play-in game, so you got to be in the round of 64. You got crushed at that point, but it was still better than you had been. Same thing for this group. Can you advance it one step further? So once you get to that second weekend and you've got some time to kind of rest up, catch your breath, evaluate where you are, now you can make a run from that point. And again, for Purdue, I almost feel bad, you know, in terms of saying it's Final Four or bust, just because of the standpoint of if when this season started, I don't think anybody was legitimately talking about this as a Final Four team. It was, how are you going to replace Jaden Ivey? And Travion Williams was a phenomenal college basketball player. Sasha Stefanovic and Eric Hunter may have had their limits, but man, they did some good things in a Purdue uniform. Man, these new guards are talented, but man, they're both true freshmen. And this is an era where, you know, guys are closer to 23, 24, 25 than they are 18 years of age. And man, Zach Edey's been great in spurts, but, you know, that lineage of, you know, A.J. Hammonds, the late Caleb Swanigan, Isaac Haas, on down the line, man, can Zach Edey be the next in line? Well, shoot, maybe he's the best of the bunch at the college level. And seriously, when, you know, he is the clear favorite for the National Player of the Year. But in terms of Purdue as a program, the question is always, when are you going to step on the banana peel? And Purdue fans, don't take that as, you know, me wanting to see that. No, quite the opposite. Purdue fans, I want to see you win the whole stinking thing. Seriously. I want to see you at least get to the Final Four. I'd love to see you in the national championship game because people in my seat root for good stories. We all have our teams we're passionate about, the teams that we care about. But when you have done this for 30 years the way I have at this point, you want to see good people win. Matt Painter's good people. His assistant coaching staff, good people. The kids that play for him that are Indiana kids, I want to see them be successful. And frankly, for you as a fan base, Purdue, you know, I'll use one of the JMB phrases. You know, schlep rock. Here we go again. I want to see you get through that. Man, the games that led up to that UVA game a few years ago, man, that was some fun basketball. Man, that ending was absolutely torturous. When the Final Four is literally in your hands and get yanked away from you at the last minute. So Purdue fans, I'm all in on your team. I want you to win. I have question marks about, for as good as Lawyer and Smith have been and are going to be for your program, I worry about kind of hitting that freshman wall and how you bounce back from it with how long that this season can go. So Purdue and Indiana fans, I want to see your teams be successful. You know, I'm that person that says, I hope everybody just plays well and has a good time. It benefits everybody in the room, which is, you know, me and Jimmy. It benefits us when you are playing well and playing well into March, because that brings more people to the table that want to listen to this radio station, that care about your basketball team. So tomorrow night's game is going to be fun. Tomorrow night's atmosphere is going to be spectacular. But are there some things I think we're going to learn about the two teams? Yes. But the ultimate questions for both of these teams start on March 12th. That's Selection Sunday, by the way. So if you want to chime in on IU Purdue stuff, feel free. Phone lines are open now, 317-239-1070. You want to chat about the Boilers or Hoosiers? On Twitter, at Greg Rakestraw. Old school email works too, greg@1070thefan.com. And I touched on this a few minutes ago, but just wanted to double back to it from a night ago. Again, Pacers Celtics was tremendous. Some of you that are on Team Tank, all for the Pacers losing that one in overtime. I'd love to add a high draft pick as well. I still, for this group, would rather have the experience, even if it's one game of a playoff, if it's two games of a playoff with that play-in round, I want to see this team be in the top 10. I think it is more beneficial knowing that your core is largely intact, all right? Miles Turner's with you for the next 2 years. Tyrese Halliburton, you hope, is your point guard for years to come. You think you found something in Neesmith. Nembhard has been an absolute find at pick number 31. You know, what does the future look like with Buddy Hield and Miles Turner after 2 years from now? Who knows? But clearly they are guys that have been good examples in the locker room for these young guys coming up. If you get a great piece in the draft, wonderful, that's a bonus. But you've got a group that you want to grow together with. I'm okay if this team is so successful that they ruin that lottery chance. It's not the popular opinion. I probably have the minority opinion on that. And feel free to engage with me on Twitter on that front too. So we'll talk Pacers with Jeremiah Johnson coming up at 12:45. But we can have that conversation in the YouTube chat room. We can have that conversation on social media. You can email it to me as well. Give me your thoughts, Greg at 1070thefan.com. If you want to join the show via the phone lines, best times today, 1:45 and 2:30 and on. Those are the open segments of the program. Other than that, kick back, relax on this chilly but beautiful Friday, and we'll do our best to educate, entertain, and inform you, or something close enough to any of those three words. We'll take this quick timeout. Brandon Gaudin on the other side. A little baseball on a cold Friday. And obviously with BG, we can talk a variety of things with him as he is the new television voice of the Atlanta Braves and always the pride of both Evansville and Butler University. He joins us next. Greg Rakestraw here with you here on the Midday Show on The Fan on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You had a solid retirement dream. Sell your home in a few years, bank the equity, downsize, and travel. But inflation and recession has you wondering if all your hard-earned equity will still be there. What if you could recession-proof your equity right now? You can with Truehold. Truehold will buy your home for its best current value before a recession can erode it. You get to bank all the cash now and live in your home for as long as you want. And Truehold covers all property taxes, insurance, repairs, and maintenance. And since Truehold pays your home's current value in cash now, it's yours to do whatever you'd like. Don't wait for inflation, recession, and interest rates to erode your home's value. Visit Truehold.com and discover how much Truehold will buy your home for today, based on its best current value, not what's coming. So call 1-855-300-9993 or visit Truehold.com, the smarter, faster way to cash out on your home's value without having to move. That's Truehold.com.
Hey, it's Dan Dockich here. You know, for years on my radio show, I asked people to help me out. I needed a treatment, aches and pains. I couldn't lose weight. Well, guess what? I found a solution. I did. Affinity Whole Health. All you've got to do is go to feelgreatindy.com and look into it for yourself. The testosterone program that I am on has been a godsend. I've missed no workouts in 6 months. No more aches and pains. And I have lost weight. FeelGreatIndy.com is the place to go. Get started just like I did.
Hey, JMV. Sometimes you're just cruising through life and, well, something happens that's just not your fault. You're in an accident and it causes injuries to both you and your family. And those medical bills can sure add up quickly. That's where Paul Cruz at Paul Ritchie Law Firm can help. Paul is recognized by the Super Lawyers Organization and his peers as one of the top personal injury attorneys in Indiana. Make that free call to see if Paul can help you at 317-269-2509. Visit parrinjury.com.
Celebrate National Margarita Day at Twin Peaks, February 22nd, with the best margarita lineup in the game. What's your go-to style? House, Peaks, Watermelon, Illegal Mezcal, or On the Rocks? And Twin Peaks has you covered with Lent Bundles kickoff February 24th. Try the fish and chips bundled with a 22-ounce draft for a steal on Fridays. Or reel in one of the other seafood options like blackened fish tacos, shrimp Caesar, and char-grilled salmon.
Twin Peaks. Eats, drinks, scenic views.
A girl in Kenya dreams of becoming a doctor. An elder in Guatemala dreams of becoming part of a community. Reach out and change their world, and it will change your own. Unbound.org.
The Ride with JMV.
The new head coach of the Colts, Shane Steichen, joins us. I'm assuming nobody's really going to outwork you in terms of preparation for anything here.
You know, the separation's in the preparation. Every day we come into work, you're on a job interview, and coaches, players, the whole building's got to be locked in at all times, and we got to have a vision for what this thing needs to look like and carry out that vision every single day and be consistent with our message.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Georgia.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Georgia. I was wondering, since yesterday was Fight Song Day, we had six different head coaches on the program. I was wondering what the musical motif was going to be from Jimmy Cook. I don't think this is like the official Georgia State song. It should be. This gentleman has been a resident of Atlanta for the last 10 years, and finally, for the first time in several years, gets to call his new home city literally his home as the van as the brand new voice of the Atlanta Braves. It is Brandon Gaudin that joins us on the Your Name Here guest line. Buddy, I am so happy for you. How are you doing?
Rake, I really appreciate it, my friend. I'm doing great. And as far as the song is concerned, I fully expected to hear Charlie Daniels' The Devil Went Down to Georgia.
You're always the good angel on his shoulder, not the devil. You much more represent that side. So I was reading your extended post announcing this about a week or so ago, I think, at this point. What I'm trying to figure out is, how is a kid that grows up on the east side of Evansville such a lifelong Atlanta Braves fan?
Well, it's a very valid question. A lot of people have asked that. So I was 7 in 1991 when I went down to Game 5 of the World Series, Braves-Twins, at Old Fulton County Stadium. The reason my family and I went to that game is because I had an aunt and uncle living in Atlanta. They still live here, and they had tickets. So we just went down to be spectators, and we were cheering for the Braves because they were. Well, at age 7, obviously a pretty impressionable time for a young kid, and I fell in love with Braves baseball that night. And then from that season on, every game was on TBS. So when I would get home from school, you could watch the Cubs on WGN before Wrigley had lights, and then you could watch the Braves at night. And so many of my friends were Cubs fans, and I just said, I'm going to be a Braves fan, and I started watching every broadcast, and from there on out, my heart was with Atlanta.
Dude, you're giving away your age, because you're my age, by saying things like that, in terms of Superstation, TBS, and Harry and Stoney, in terms of every matinee afternoon you got home from school on WGN. So I know that you have had the chance to do some games for FS1 over the last few years. Has this always been a goal of yours, if the opportunity presented itself, to route more towards baseball?
Yeah, baseball was always my first love. And when I left Butler, I graduated from there in 06, so I'll fully date myself. When I graduated from Butler, I knew that baseball is what I wanted to start out doing. And so my first job was in minor league ball, out rookie A, short season, 76 games in 80 days, making $500 a month and eating clubhouse peanut butter and jelly. And that was what I wanted to start in, and that my path deviated from that as basketball and football opportunities came along. But baseball was always my first passion. And living in Atlanta, kind of reconnecting with the Braves, I was excited to have that opportunity just to be in the city. I never thought the play-by-play job would open up, because their voice, Chip Carey, who's now the Cardinals' voice, everyone just expected he would retire here like his father Skip did. Mm-hmm. And that obviously didn't happen. It really caught everybody by surprise when he left for St. Louis. But as soon as I heard that news and the opportunity opened up, I knew it was one that I wanted to pounce on. And so it all happened very quickly within the span of about 7 to 10 days. And now here we are, fast forward to today, about another week later.
All right, so Atlanta Braves are the one that have kind of gone against the downtown trend. They are now out in Cobb County. We all know, because all of us Indiana folks that go to Florida at any point in time, we always plan our trips around, okay, when do I hit Atlanta at the quote-unquote proper time to minimize the traffic? How long will it take you to get to the ballpark on a regular basis?
The good news for me is with no traffic, which, knock on wood, I don't think that's going to happen very often.
Right.
With no traffic, I'm only about 12 minutes from the park.
Okay.
But realistically, I'm in a path that is not as heavily trafficked. I'm going away from downtown. So So I think on most nights, it'll only take me 12 to 15 minutes to get up there. So really, I'm in a pretty good spot. Look, when that ballpark moved away from downtown, so they had Fulton County Stadium that I referenced, and yep. then they moved to Turner after the Olympics were here in 96. I love both of those parks. I was in those parks a zillion times. And so I had an affinity for downtown Atlanta, but I understand why they moved the park where they did. It's a little less congested, and they wanted to build up the area around it. And if folks haven't been, it's kind of a new age thing that everybody's doing where you put bars and shops yep. and restaurants, and you make it an event. You make it a destination, and they've done incredibly well with it. It's really cool.
I know you touched on this a few days ago as well. Obviously, this time of year, you still have the chance to do college basketball. I'm sure you're going to work in some college and NFL football. What is the calendar going to look like for you around your Braves schedule?
Yeah, so that's what is sweet about it is I can still do all of that other stuff. In fact, our first spring training broadcast, Braves only broadcast 4 on TV, is not until March 23rd. So I can still do the Big Ten tournament in Chicago. I can still do the NCAA tournament for Westwood One. And then as soon as I'm done with that, I will head down to North Point where the Braves are and do those 4 games. And then you'll turn around and it'll be March 30th. And they'll be throwing the first pitch in D.C. against the Nationals. And I'm guessing that it'll probably be 37 degrees with freezing rain. But that's all part of the experience.
All right. Can you believe it's been 10 years since you've been the voice of the Butler Bulldogs?
I was just talking with my brother about that. No, I can't. And last night I had Penn State against Ohio State, and I was catching up with Micah Shrewsbury, who, of sure. course, was an assistant on those teams under Brad Stevens. And we were reminiscing about the good old days. And then he said, man, that seems like yesterday, but it was a while ago. And I said, yeah, you're exactly right. A lot has changed for a lot of people since then. But it's been a while. Interestingly, my next couple of games, Rake, are Butler games. I've got Butler up there against Marquette this coming Tuesday, so I'll get to Hinkle. And then I've got Butler finishing up at Xavier down at the Cintas Center on March 4th. So I'll get a couple looks here, the alma mater coming up really soon.
Now, as you know, when I hear you on a broadcast, and if I think there is a really nerd level nugget that you might not have, I am one to DM you and say, hey, if you can work this into the broadcast, like, for example, there was this thing called the Spring League, you know, before the XFL, yeah. like third version, or after the XFL second version, before the USFL, I'm doing PA for a game in Indianapolis that Brandon is yeah. calling from a studio in Los Angeles. I said, hey, by the way, when Reese Horn catches, make sure you drop University of Indianapolis and played here in the state championship game. And literally within 3 minutes, Brandon's going, you know, Reese Horn played here for the Cathedral Fighting Irish. And I'm like, at least the man checks his messages. So Butler's obviously been very hit or miss over the course of this year.
Yeah.
If it gets to walk-on time for Marquette, Jonah Lucas played yeah. at Lafayette Harrison High School. I went to college with his dad, Perel, who was one of the best players in the history of the University of Indianapolis. So if you need okay. some more information on, like, the 14th dude in a Marquette uniform, in case it gets to that level, BG, there you go.
Well, I hope it doesn't get to that point, because that means that our broadcast is not very entertaining because someone was winning by a lot. So, but I can always count on you for the under-the-radar nugget that nobody else has. You always have more facts, figures, and nuggets on players and people from the past that nobody else has. So keep firing them my way, and I'll keep passing them along.
Right? That's also called, you know, being old. So do you get to keep the Lions gig in the preseason as well? You going to work your schedule around that too?
Trying to figure that out. That one's one that might have to go by the wayside just because, you know, August, September for football is going to be tough. That's when the Braves sure. likely will be in a pennant race. So I'm trying to figure out those 3 games for the Lions and then how September football is going to look for me. Reality is probably not going to be able to do much those 2 months. And I told the Braves when I interviewed, because they asked me, hey, with everything else you've got going on, how do we fit into the picture? And I said, look, if I take this gig, this is right. the epicenter for me. This is the meat and potatoes. And so I want to be there certainly with them toward the end of the season. And so that's going to be something I've got to figure out here in the next couple of months. But my focus will be on Atlanta.
My friend, you have shown an incredible acumen, and it's not an easy task to do, to bounce back and forth from radio to television. So I acknowledge what I'm about to ask you is usually more of a radio thing and usually more of a, you know, John Sterling thing to have like an individual home run call per player. You have some tremendous young talent you'll be seeing on the Braves on a regular basis. You go on like, are you starting to let your mind wonder in terms of, all right, here's the Ozzie Albies call, here's the Acuna call. Have you put pen to paper on things like that just yet?
I really haven't, and I think sometimes, and Rake, you'll probably agree with me, announcers kind of poo-poo the idea of coming up with something right beforehand. But the reality is I think most have at least thought about it and ventured down that road, whether they want to admit it or not. But I truly have not yet. I'm not saying I won't before opening day, but I'm hoping that a lot of that comes organic, so maybe it feels a little less contrived and corny. But no doubt, I think when you're the voice of a team, those things become cool and they become endearing to a fan base. So I'm sure once I'm, you know, game 30, game 60, end of the season, that some of those will start to come out. Hopefully a couple of them stick.
I'll be honest with you. I think about it for like the end of the game. Like I don't think about trying to have like, you know, to use an example, I'll give you an example in basketball. So last year, with all the high school stuff that I do, I wanted to make sure I had Beech Grove in the semi-state and Beech Grove in the state championship game. And Beech Grove lost their AD and head coach, who battled brain cancer multiple times and passed away 3 or 4 years ago at this point. And I wanted to make sure that I worked in a reference to him. I'm like, okay, I've got to work him in the call because this is going to be, you know, kind of the send-off moment, the things that somebody's going to clip this up and play it back. I want to make sure his name gets worked in there. And because it's Beech Grove, and let's face it, okay, Beech Grove is often the butt of a joke from a time to time for those of us elsewhere around the area. And the Walmart down there has produced some wonderful slash terrible moments, depending on your perspective. So I use the same call for the semi-state and the state finals when they won. And I said, for Matt English and for Beech Grove. And that's the one time in a broadcast that I go, I want to make sure on that final moment that is the most clipped moment of the game, the final call, that I want to kind of rehearse in my mind. Everything else, I try to let kind of go. And now I will step off my soapbox. That is my broadcaster TED Talk for the day. Thank you very much.
No, I like it. The only thing I'll follow up with, all of us have had this discussion throughout the course of our careers. I do find myself, if it's a big game and we're at the final media timeout and there's going to be a huge upset or number one is going to lose, I do find myself thinking, okay, what's a quick call that I can punch with when the buzzer sounds to call it and get out of the way and set the moment? And so those moments do happen. I never anymore go into a broadcast thinking, if this happens, then I'll say this. I don't do that anymore. But I'd be lying if I said, again, when there's a minute left, you're like, oh my gosh, they might knock them off. I need to say something here a little profound that I haven't at least thought in my head ahead of time a bit. But I try to make it as organic as possible, and I certainly think that that's the best way to do it, because the most euphoric calls, the most memorable calls, all the great ones, I think, have come out of, first of all, great plays that have just made us all say things spontaneously. But I just think when you hit that note and it's off the top of your head, you can just tell, and it just sounds better and more natural.
I'm being Brandon Gaudin, new television voice of the Atlanta Braves, our guest, Greg Rakestraw, here on the Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan, couple quick things, and then we'll let you go. Seeing as many Big Ten games as you have over the course of the last few weeks, obviously Purdue is awfully good. If there is another team, take away the top team off of that group. If there is a team that you think will make a deep tournament run coming from the Big Ten, who's it going to be?
I'm not just saying this because I'm on with you and back in my home state. I really think it's Indiana. And that's not to say that I'm sitting here projecting they're going to make a deep run, because I realize how vulnerable they are. I realize it's been an up-and-down season. But when they are clicking, and again, I emphasize when they are clicking, I think they're right there behind Purdue with a team that can make a run in the NCAA tournament. There are others. I think Illinois has capabilities. I really like Northwestern. I just think with their lack of interior presence, sometimes they can be a little vulnerable. But I would put Indiana up there behind Purdue when it comes to March. And yeah, a lot of it, look, we always say when you get in the tournament, seeding and matchups, that's everything. It can bounce you early. It cannot go your way. And we've seen Indiana this time be so Jekyll and Hyde that I would be scared to pick them into the second weekend. But I know that when they've got everything humming, that is a team with just loads of talent and potential. So I'm curious to see what Indiana does here down the stretch, what they do in Chicago in the Big Ten tournament, and then if they can make some noise in the big dance.
Always a Butler Bulldog and always a good dude. Brandon Gaudin joining us in the program. My friend, again, I'm so happy for you. Don't be a stranger. Safe travels. We'll catch up again real soon.
Thanks so much, Rake. Always great to visit with you, and I'll talk to you soon, my friend.
You got it, buddy. Brandon Gaudin on the Your Name Here hotline. We'll take this quick timeout. We'll talk about the Indiana Pacers. Heck of a game last night. Just the wrong ending. Or was it? Jeremiah Johnson joins us next. The Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Why does We Grow Hair Indy have the best hair transplant results? Because they have the best technology. And I'm living proof of it. Hey, this is JMV. We Grow Hair Indy has the technology that restored both my bald spot in my crown area and PRP to keep my hairline and non-transplanted hair looking good. This year, they can restore your bald spot and your hairline. Call 317-522-2995. 317-522-2995. Here's Darren Andrews to explain.
Having that strong hairline again completely changes the way you see yourself. It makes a huge difference. A lot of people think the crown cannot be transplanted. It's actually an area of specialty for us with our multi-unit hair grafting.
My hair is going to grow the rest of my life, and that's exactly what I want. Call 317-522-2995 to schedule your free evaluation. That's 317-522-2995, and check out my results at wegrowhairindy.com, the gold standard in hair restoration.
Spring in Indy. And since 2001, Rhino Shield has been covering Indiana homes and businesses. Just ask Mike.
I was watching TV one night and saw the Rhino Shield ad. And I thought, well, if they can do a house, they can probably do a building.
And Rhino Shield's not paint. It's better.
So they came out and they gave me a price, showed me how the Rhino works, how it lasts, and how the guarantee works.
Business owners, you too can get the 25-year protection of Rhino Shield right now for 15% off the regular price.
They started on the building. They waited for us to leave, and they worked Saturday and Sunday so they wouldn't affect our business at all. This was the great part of it. I came back Sunday night, and you couldn't even tell they were here. There was no paint on the ground. They did a fantastic job.
Here's owner Shane Smith.
This offer is limited, so call me at 888-RHINO-41. That's 888-RHINO-41.
Don't paint.
Don't vinyl.
Go Rhino.
Don't vinyl, go Rhino Shield. Never paint your house again. Rhino Shield.
To everyone who believes in tradition, let our team member Caitlin share one that's been at the heart of Culver's since the beginning.
In Wisconsin, we love a good fish fry, like really love. And bringing friends and family together over a fresh meal is how we've always done it at Culver's. It's why we still hand batter our North Atlantic cod to order and cook it to crispy golden perfection. Sharing our Wisconsin favorites with all of you, that's what really makes our day.
Come to Culver's and get a taste of our fish fry tradition.
From Wisconsin with love,
welcome to Delicious. To everyone who needs a little delight in their day, let our team member Paul tell you about one of our favorite sweet treats.
Making special moments at mealtime is a tradition in Wisconsin. And what better way to sweeten your day than a blue spoonful of a Culver's Concrete Mixer? We handcraft our fresh frozen custard with your favorite mix-ins, so every bite is exactly the way you like. From caramel to your favorite candies like crispy, crunchy Butterfinger.
Come to Culver's and let us make your day a little bit sweeter. From Wisconsin with love, welcome to Delicious.
Find your outdoor adventure at the Ford 68th Annual Indianapolis Boat, Sport, and Travel Show. February 17th through 19th and 22nd through 26th at the Indiana State Fairgrounds. Over 750,000 square feet of the latest boats, RVs, power sports, motorcycles, Tackletown USA, travel destinations from across North America, and much more. Save money and buy tickets online at IndySportsShow.com. And don't miss the 25th Annual Indiana Deer, Turkey, and Waterfowl Expo during the final 4 days of the sports show. February 23rd through 26th at the Indiana State Fairgrounds. It's the largest hunting expo in the Midwest, displaying the latest hunting, archery, and waterfowl gear. Hunting outfitters from around the globe. Learn from the pros at the Hunting Seminar Series. Get your deer scored and see the Hoosier Record Book Hall of Fame. One ticket gets you into both shows. Save money and buy tickets online at IndySportsShow.com. Another Renfro production.
JMV here for the absolute best in realty. That's Mark Deedle. Mark Deedle Realty, 317-755-4232. 317-755-4232. That's markdeedle.com. MarkDIETEL.com. Today, the guarantees that we all love. In fact, Mark Deedle guarantees an offer in 3 days for full market value, or he will list it for free. Nothing better than that. And then the outcome of those that have used Mark before. Like Chris and Carly in Indianapolis, they were going to get jobs moving out of the country, which they were excited about, but the prospect of trying to get something done with their Indy home was a little bit daunting until they called on the absolute best. That's Mark Deedle. Mark Deedle got the job done. The best in realty, that's Mark Deedle at 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232. Online, markdeedle.com, markdietel.com today.
People who come to Cricut stay with Cricut, just like our customer, Christine.
I'm a director and a performer. I got a free phone from Cricut, and I've used it to live stream 73 of my shows on social media.
How do you like it?
It's fabulous!
Switch to Cricut and get a free Samsung Galaxy A14 5G. Smile, you're on Cricut.
Real customer paid for testimonial limited time. Must bring your number to Cricut on a $60 a month. First month service charge and tax due at sale. Phone streams, video, and SD. Cricut 5G is not available everywhere. Fees, terms, and other restrictions apply. See CricutWireless.com for details.
Did your health club just eliminate basketball? Pickup USA Fitness invites you to take a look. $99 initiation fee, cut to $50 if you act now. PickupUSAFitness.com.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan.
And 107.5, The Fan.
Jimmy Cook on the ones and twos. Brandon Gaudin in the last segment of the show. Colts tight end Kylen Granson coming up in the next segment. A young man that is chasing a record that has stood for over five decades. Antoine Davis, Detroit Mercy in the 1 o'clock hour. Indy 11 head coach Mark Lowry. Later on in the program, my name is Greg Rakestraw. This is The Fan Midday Show on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan, of the phone lines as he is on his way to the airport, or soon will be, from Pacers Television in Bally Sports, Indiana. It is Jeremiah Johnson. Hello, JJ. How are you?
Fantastic. Happy Friday. Should be a fun basketball weekend in these parts.
No doubt about it. What is the temperature when you land in Orlando today?
Having just come back from Orlando for a little All-Star break vacation, I know that about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it was usually near 80, so nothing like this, although when we landed, I felt like I did bring some of the warmth with me because it's been nothing to complain about for February in Indiana. So I'm going to guess around 75 or 80 when we get there.
All right. It could be for a variety of reasons. Cities that you think is cool, a fond memory, whatever the case may be. You've got 29 other destinations you go to around the NBA, and after a couple of years of not doing that, you're now back on the travel grind. Give me a city or two that is your favorite to visit for whatever reason.
Yeah, I'll say Denver is one of my favorites. It's depending upon how cold it is, but downtown Denver is a place that I didn't really explore a lot until being a part of the Pacers and traveling, and I just feel like there's a lot to do, a lot of cool places to eat and friends to see, and it's just it's a good arena as well to get around and work. And actually, I'll highlight Orlando. It's not one of the newer arenas, but it's maybe one of my favorite from a working environment. It's bright. It just feels comfortable when I'm in the building. And so those are I never have an issue going to Orlando. We've stayed at some different places, and we've seen some different parts of Orlando. Traffic can be a little bit of an issue. So Denver's definitely on the top of the list. Maybe Orlando, just because I'm going there, it's top of mind. Maybe it's more in that 5 through 10 category. Another one that I'll throw out to you would be Portland, depending upon the weather. I do want to go to Portland sometime in the summertime, but as long as it's not cold and rainy, I do enjoy a visit to Portland just because it's a little bit different than some of the other places.
I have seen your Facebook post, and I can't remember exactly where this was, but there are some places you get a wonderful courtside seat to do your job, and there's some places where I think they literally put you underneath the bleachers on an end zone. What are the spots that absolutely again, we don't dig ditches for a living. You and I get paid to go to ball games for a living, and we get paid handsomely, and you are handsome, and that's a conversation for a different day. When it comes to the worst place for you to actually watch a game and do your job, what is it?
Well, it is Atlanta, and I haven't yet been there this season. There's only one Pacers game in Atlanta as part of this current schedule, but it's in a tunnel, and it's not with really a great view of the court, so sometimes I just walk around and find a seat in the first couple of rows that no one is sitting in, and I'll report from there. Charlotte's another one where they've got the tunnel spot. So when there's a chair and it's in the tunnel and it's kind of away from the court, it's not that ideal, but coming to mind would be Charlotte and Atlanta right now. So those southern locations aren't the best. And San Antonio is also of that category, and we'll be heading there later this week.
They're 14-46. There's plenty of empty seats. You can sit in the front row courtside and be just fine when you go to San Antonio. All right, let's talk about last night's game. It stood out to me, just the small portion I got to watch happened to be the third quarter on the replay. And to hear Chris basically say, this is as good of basketball, meaning both teams combined, as we have seen all year, your observation on just how good both teams were coming out of the All-Star break last night.
Yeah, you never really know what you're going to get in that first game after a break, and both teams had players that were busy All-Star weekend. So I personally thought at least the Celtics, maybe they would be a little sluggish, having had to travel, having that early game, and you would expect maybe Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown, maybe they went somewhere after Salt Lake City. So I thought they might be a little sluggish. Maybe they were thinking about that game where the Pacers beat them in Boston, and they were determined. And so when the Pacers were down 10 at halftime, it was an unusual feeling because you think, okay, 10-point halftime deficit, it must have been a bad first half. That was the team with the best record in the NBA playing at what I thought was a really high level. And for the Pacers to be only down 10 at halftime, I thought they were in a good spot. And then the way they started that third quarter, and really from an offensive perspective, it never really stopped. I would invite anyone that has the access, go back and watch that third quarter. It was different times where you have to be encouraged because Boston, a team with championship aspirations, would go up 9, would go up 10, and you'd think, okay, well, it's not going to be the Pacers' night. And every single time, they battled back. And if they just had a bounce here or there, go a different direction, they win that game in regulation. Going into overtime, Boston was just, 1%, 2% better is how I described it on the postgame show. So it was a loss. The Pacers haven't had a lot of success in the calendar year of 2023, but all losses are not created equal, and I thought there were a lot of positives coming out of the game.
Off the top of my head, I think your time being the sideline guy for the Pacers is almost simultaneous with Miles Turner being drafted by the team. So literally, I think you've been on the broadcast of probably 95% of the games he's played in the NBA. Was last night his single best game in a Pacers uniform?
Wow, it was pretty good, and we noted during the postgame show, just scanning the box score, you knew he didn't get a ton of shots, but to only miss 2, I think he was 13 for 15 from the field. We'll have to do some research prior to tomorrow's pregame show. I can't imagine too many 40-point games with guys only shooting 15
right.
shots and not having, 20 made free throws. It was so efficient. Nothing was forced. And the amount of fun that he was having, especially in that third quarter, and I couldn't believe the Celtics, they like to switch a lot on defense. They were continuing to leave him open, and the only thing after the game I thought about was it's too bad he didn't maybe get a couple of extra looks late in regulation or in the overtime period because he was playing well. And the best part of it is it's been consistent. I think that was his fifth 30-point game of the season, and he only had 4 in his entire 7 previous NBA seasons. And so from start to finish, he hasn't been forcing things, but he's been consistent. And I know you mentioned earlier in your show, it's been a lightning rod at times in his career on John's show, especially.
Sure.
Because he'll have these good games, and then maybe you'll have a, 8-point, 3-rebound kind of game, and then all the naysayers will say, well, yeah, they'll point to that one. It's been really consistent this season, and it's been offense and defense. You knew what he would bring defensively at this point in his career, but to be that consistent offensively, it's been a really good sign, and I just appreciated everything that's happened this season, where you didn't have any real definitive, good feeling that he was going to be here for a long time. Even Miles wouldn't have thought that, and things changed a lot and he's just played really well.
Have you sensed, I'm not saying difference in his game, but just kind of even, I mean, personality is not even the right word, but knowing that the contract situation is at least handled for the next couple of years, and those questions have gone away, and again, it looks like his tenure here is going to continue at least for the next year or two. Do you kind of get a sense of ease from him on that subject now?
And I think it actually started before the contract was officially signed. He's been one of our better interviews on the team, but there have been times maybe, you know, 2 years ago, times where he was struggling trying to fit in that pairing with Domantas Sabonis, where in the best of moods. And I think really from training camp on, he's been in a really good mood. He's been a leader. He's been someone that has used his voice, not just led with his actions. And I think you have to have some of those guys. And then the closer it got to where maybe no one really knew he was for sure going to re-sign, but maybe he felt that way in that December run when the Pacers won 8 of 10, I just felt like that he was in a really good place. And then obviously when you sign that contract and you have that press conference and you have the entire organization there to show their appreciation, it has to make you feel good. And these guys are no different than anyone else. They want to be told, you know, how much they mean. And I think that Miles means a lot to this team. Loyalty, something that he has shown. How many players have been in the league from that draft class that are still with the team that drafted them? There are not too many. So I think he's in a really good spot mentally. I think he's in a good spot physically, and also playing alongside Tyrese Halliburton has helped immensely.
Again, Jeremiah Johnson, of course, Bally Sports Indiana, Pacers Television. Our guest, Greg Rakestraw, with you on the Fan Midday Show on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan, couple quick things. We'll let him go and get to the airport, knowing there is a flight to Orlando that will take place for the Pacers coming up this afternoon. Of course, the game you'll hear right here tomorrow night on 93.5 and 107.5, the Fan as well. George Hill didn't play a single minute last night, and there are probably going to be, you know, several nights that could be like that for him. What do you see his role being on this team for the next 21 games?
Well, you know George well. Yep. And, I mean, I go back to, you know, hearing about him. I was in Terre Haute. We heard about him as a high school phenom. I think there was a game where Broad Ripple came over to Northview, and he lit up the Knights for 50-some points, maybe more than that. And there have been times early in his NBA career where you wondered if he would be the guy that would want to stick around and be a veteran leader while he was not playing. And he's changed a lot. I mean, he has not been shy about saying that he wants to be a part of this team. He wants to retire as a Pacer. Would love to have even that James Johnson role. I mean, I'm not sure there is a spot for in a 15-man roster to have two of those guys. Sure. That are your veteran leaders. But we'll see what happens in the offseason. I took note, his first day back with the Pacers was a Friday. He was not dressed, but yet he, you know, obviously went around, met all of his teammates. The game started, and he was as vocal during the timeouts and in the huddles as anyone on that team. And it's a vocal team. I mean, he pulled Benedict Mathurin aside. We have a video clip of him during a timeout talking with him about a defensive scheme and adjustment where there was 30 seconds of George Hill and Benedict Mathurin. And this is Benedict Mathurin as a rookie. George Hill, I'm not even sure what year he's in.
15.
They had never even met. And so that shows a lot about how much he's grown and how that's the role he'll have for the rest of the season. There may be some games in late March or early April, maybe especially you would hope home games, where he's going to get another opportunity to play like he did in that first game in uniform. But other than that, I think he's perfectly fine with the role. If there are injuries, he'll be ready. Other than that, he'll continue to provide guidance and advice. And to have George and James Johnson, Daniel Tice even, I'll say, as vets on this team, that sometimes they'll play, maybe sometimes they won't, but they're always providing positive influence and perspective. I think it helps a young team.
JJ, as always, buddy, appreciate your time. Good to catch up with you, and enjoy Central Florida for like the second time in a week. Safe travels.
Never a bad thing to get on a plane in February to go to Orlando.
There you go, buddy. Take care. Again, that is Jeremiah Johnson, of course, Bally Sports Indiana and Pacers TV on the currently unnamed guest line. We'll go from talking about the Pacers, talking about the Colts. Colts tight end Kylen Granson will be joining us. We'll talk about his book drive and what he thinks year three will look like for him in Indianapolis. That and more come your way. Next is the Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Fan Query.
We got our guy. It is official. The Indianapolis Colts have hired Shane Steichen. Pen to paper there at 37 years old. Like we said, the youngest head coach in the history of the Indianapolis Colts.
He has worked with various quarterbacks, notably Philip Rivers, Justin Herbert, Jalen Hurts. As we have mentioned, that gives him kind of a versatility of the style of quarterback.
Kevin and Query.
Weekday mornings at 7
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Be here with an exclusive scoop on how you can attend the NFL Combine for free. Get inside Lucas Oil Stadium to see future NFL stars up close. At the Combine Experience, you can pass, punt, and run. To attend for free March 2nd through the 5th, just go to visitindy.com/combine to sign up for free tickets and parking. The NFL Combine up close with the best college football has to offer March the 2nd through the 5th. Get your free tickets at visitindy.com/combine. See you there.
Hey, it's Dan Dockich here. You know, for years on my radio show, I asked people to help me out. I needed a treatment. Aches and pains. I couldn't lose weight. Well, guess what? I found a solution. I did. Affinity Whole Health. All you've got to do is go to feelgreatindy.com and look into it for yourself. The testosterone program that I am on has been a godsend. I've missed no workouts in 6 months. No more aches and pains. And I have lost weight. FeelGreatIndy.com is the place to go. Get started just like I did.
Hey there, it's JMV. If you have clogged drains, listen up. There are some clogs a plunger simply cannot fix. That's when you need a professional, and I highly recommend the team at LD Smith Plumbing to handle any water problem in your home, especially clogged drains. They have the know-how and the latest equipment to find the clog and remove it. They're truly water's boss. In the frustration of clogged drains, visit LDSmithPlumbing.com today and request an appointment. That's LDSmithPlumbing.com today.
Are your ankylosing spondylitis or AS symptoms still not under control?
Stairs? No, no way.
Is your treatment still not working?
Mornings? Moving? No.
Tired of saying no? Talk to your rheumatologist about a different treatment option. Visit ConfrontAS.com, and next time, you may just say,
why, yes, I will go for that run.
Visit ConfrontAS.com. Sponsored by AbbVie.
This is Ryan Newman for Indiana Donor Network and Driven to Save Lives. I love my family, and I appreciate every moment we spend together. We've talked about some pretty tough stuff over the years, and one thing they know for sure is that I've signed up to be an organ donor. So the next time you're with your family, take a moment and let them know you love them, and be sure they know your decision to be an organ donor. You can learn more at DonateLifeIndiana.org.
Imagine the possibilities of getting the backyard of your dreams. Expand your living space with an Indy Decorative Concrete patio. Indy Decorative Concrete, the patio experts.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W298BB. WIBC HD3 W228CX, Indianapolis.
The IHSAA Girls Basketball State Finals. Tomorrow morning at 11. On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Greg Rakestraw is my name. You got two more hours of me. You got one more hour tomorrow morning. Then you got a couple of more hours of me later in the day tomorrow doing the 2A Girls State Finals. I don't work here full-time anymore. I'm still on this place all the time. Ain't it great? And I'm sure I'll call in at some point in time in the 9 o'clock hour down the hall tomorrow night for the JMB Takeover on B105.7. I couldn't make it last. We was a little busy with the high school wrestling state finals that had me like at Gainbridge Fieldhouse for 5 hours and happened right during the middle of the show. So I couldn't have my deep cut that I normally do when I call the program. I'll get with JMB today, get a theme, the whole nine yards, get it worked out. So that'll be at some point in time in the 9 o'clock hour tomorrow in terms of the evening. 317-239-1070. Probably got time to sneak in a quick telephone call here if you'd like. Kylen Granson, the Colts, scheduled to dial us up in just a couple of minutes. He's got a book drive that he's doing and happy to give him some pub for that. In exchange, we'll talk some Colts off season with him coming up in just a matter of moments. I promised I would interact with those on the YouTube chat room from Naptonius Monk. In terms of the Pacers, said you got to be more farsighted, Greg. It's good to win this year, but I want them to be perennial winners. They need more top-end talent to get that done. Mid-tier picks probably won't get it done. On the flip side, let me give you this from Luke on Twitter. I'm with you that I want the Pacers to make the playoffs. People forget that young Pacers team that made the playoffs in 2010 as an 8 seed against the 1 seed Bulls. Valuable experience for a team that eventually became a title contender. I see the same in this team. Luke, I think that's a very fair comparison. You got to remember that that team in 2010, that was their first playoff trip in 4 years, if I remember properly. That 2006 was, maybe it was 07 in terms of one of those, but it had been a while. It had been a long walk in the wilderness. We're not to that point with this group yet. And again, I think one more piece is needed for this group, but I think it's really about this group playing together and developing. You've got a kind of a core of 5, 6, 7 guys. You're looking to add one more. I'd rather have the playoff experience for this group. If not, so be it. You get the higher draft pick. But I actually think it's a good thing if you, you know, win games instead of losing them. But again, I think I'm in the minority of that opinion. We just had JJ on the show. That's Jeremiah Johnson. This is another JJ that wants to call in and talk Pacers. Hello, JJ.
Hey, Greg. How you doing, my man?
I'm good, buddy. How are you?
I can't complain, man. I can't complain. I appreciate you. Hey, first of all, go Ball State. Go Cubs. Let's do it. Boilermakers beat the IU Hoosiers this weekend. That's on one point. secondly, what do you think about George Hill, because he's a great man of the community. He has his AAU program that he has with all the teams and everything. And he's coming. He wants to retire as a Pacer. What are your thoughts on him maybe moving into the player development role, on the player development staff with the Indiana Pacers as he gets closer to retirement, as far as, you know, him being back and everything, if they're transitioning, if that's a possibility? I think it'd be good myself.
JJ, that's a phenomenal thought, and I guarantee you that George has started to have those ideas. And again, you know my relationship with George. I have known him for 15 years, known him for 20 years, actually, dating back to his freshman year at IUPUI, which is 2004-2005. Ironically, his first college basketball game was the night after the Pacers brawl in Auburn Hills. And that was his first game the next night for IUPUI. Oh, wow. And the growth that he's had as a person, you know, I'm so proud of him, and but it almost sounds condescending. I don't want it to be. I'm so happy for him that life has turned out the way that it has, and not just from his basketball playing standpoint, but how he has grown as a person and the things that he is involved in with trying to bring back a high school at Broad Ripple, the AAU program that you cited. Whether it's here with this team or any NBA team, they'd be lucky to have him in some front office role, JJ. Let's put it that way.
I agree, and I appreciate you putting that out. Yes, he definitely. I ref high school basketball. This is my 23rd year. I just finished, and I've had the opportunity to ref in his AAU programs quite a bit. So I just put that plug out there. And I know you need to go. But lastly, the Pacers and the Pacers versus Celtics reminded me of Chuck Person against Larry Bird.
1991.
Yes. It reminded me of that game so much so last night.
Yeah.
I believe it was. And if they could just stay, the last time, my question to you, when's the last time that we had a really cohesive Pacer team that just stayed cohesive through the mess and became fluid to really get back in the playoffs and be a formidable team?
About 10 or 11 years ago, JJ is your answer, buddy. Thanks for the telephone call. We'll talk more Pacers later in the show, but we have a member of the Indianapolis Colts on the hotline. Let's get to him now. Again, you can come meet him at the Kroger at 116th and Olio coming up next Saturday from 11 until 1. And please support his book drive at all Indianapolis Kroger locations for the remainder of the month of March. It is Kylen Granson that joins us now. Kylen, this is Greg. How's your offseason going, buddy?
Oh, it's fantastic. Always. Oh, it's always a nice time to get a nice, you know, breath right before the next season.
I know that that causes like this have been important to you even before you ever took, you know, to count your first pass with the Colts the previous season. The website for more information, this is kgskids.com. Where was it, you know, kind of ingrained in you in an early age to be more than just a football player and be an active member of whatever community you were going to be in?
Oh, definitely started early. With my mom as an educator, you know, the community was definitely an important part of my life. And, you know, reading was what, you know, got me into college, got me into great schools, and has led to the opportunity to play in the NFL. And, you know, it's made a lot of changes in my life. It made me the person I am today, and, you know, trying to help these kids out here up in Indy, trying to get them as maybe not as obsessed with reading as I was, but, you know, just, you know, instilling that passion, get them into it, because it can lead to a lot of roads, whatever they're passionate in, it'll help them succeed.
Again, the book drive kicks off next Saturday, kgskids.com. 10,000 books is the goal, and you can donate over the course of 4 weeks at Indianapolis Kroger locations. We'll plug that a couple of more times before we go out the door. If you're obsessed with reading as a kid, this is the time of the year. You don't have to read the playbook for the team. What are you reading now during your brief bit of downtime?
Oh, well, I got some fantasy books right now. I'm reading some Joe Abercrombie. Finished Red Rising. That was a great series. But yeah, I'm catching up. I had a lot on my wish list, and slowly getting there.
So again, just to clarify, folks, when he says fantasy, not fantasy football, different type of fantasy that Kylen is referring to. Well, obviously, yeah. this season did not go the way that you or anybody else in that locker room had intended. When you look back to 2022, whether you play one more year in the league or 10 more years in the league, what do you learn from that experience and try to apply going forward?
Oh, man. There's definitely quite a few things to learn. If I had to take away one lesson, definitely that, you know, it's all about the locker room. You got to keep everything in. You know, don't listen to what all the outside people are saying. You know, everybody was talking mess about us for good, you know, two-thirds of the season. You know, it makes it tough to go out there and perform, you know, but, you know, as long as you keep it with your teammates and they keep it real, you keep it real, it kind of helps you weather that storm.
Individually, where do you feel you made the best progress as a player from year one to year two?
Oh, man, I felt so much more comfortable out there. I felt like I was playing, like, twice as fast as I normally did. It was great. Blocking, I felt like I was moving dudes off the line. I was definitely getting my yak up, so I was moving after the catch. Yeah, I feel like I made some good overall steps in just about every area.
So in the last 2 weeks, have you found yourself, like, going back and watching Philadelphia Eagles game tape from this year to kind of have an idea what a Shane Steichen offense is going to look like for your football team?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And it looks great. It looks great. I'm excited. I'm so excited.
As a player, you have to give yourself some downtime. You have to give yourself some time away. You frankly got to let your body heal a little bit. Mm-hmm. When the season ended on January the 8th, how long did you kind of let yourself completely get away from things?
Till about the end of January.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just got away from it, didn't look at anything. Obviously, you know, once Super Bowl roll around, you can't ignore it then. So obviously I was watching, you know, playoff ball. But started working out, I want to say, second week of February, so 2 weeks ago.
Yep.
Started getting back into it, but, yeah, starting to get back in shape.
team activities start for you guys pretty much like late March, early April, correct?
Correct, yes, sir.
What have you learned kind of, obviously, when you go from college to the pros, your draft workouts, then you're, you know, thrown into the mix in terms of minicamp, there is no break for you as a rookie, frankly. Between year one and year two, you get a little bit of a break. So, again, I'll ask you to compare last year to this. What did you learn about the process last offseason that you apply to this time around?
Last offseason, you definitely have a lot more time than, you know, rookie year. And a lot of it is just, you know, making sure you're eating right. You know, don't get tempted by that, you know, 24-ounce cake. Not stay away from it. You know, and just being smart with the way you eat. And then really the training, you know, the training doesn't really change. It's just making sure you keep up with your nutrition and following your plan.
I asked you about, you know, the progress you made from year one to year two. I'm sure you're setting goals this offseason to make that same level of progress from year two to year three. What are you kind of focusing in on yourself, saying, all right, this is where I want to continue to improve or be better in 2023?
Man, I'm trying to make more plays with the ball in my hand. You know, I'm usually making plays out there on third down, and I want to keep that up. I want to be, you know, like a go-to guy on those must-needed, you know, situations. And, you know, I need to find the end zone, God dang it. I need to get in there for sure. So those are two things on my goals for this year.
I guess I had not realized that you and I have the same career NFL touchdowns. I guarantee you'll pass me in the very near future on that front. Off-season wise, I know you're going to be back here. If you're not here in Indianapolis early, obviously you're going to be here for the book, you know, donations that start next Saturday. How you like living in Indianapolis so far these last couple of years?
Oh, I love it. My mom's side of the family is all up here, so I get to see all my cousins, you know, my great aunts. I get to see all of them. And, you know, I love Indy. I get to see all four seasons, you know.
Right.
Winter kind of stays around, but I don't do bad this year. So, no, I actually love it. There's something to do. There's always somewhere to go. Yeah, I love it.
I asked if you're studying Philadelphia Eagles game tape. Are you letting yourself kind of peek into the NFL draft? So many people are saying, hey, Colts are going quarterback at 4 or somewhere in that, you know, early range. Are you turning into like a mini Mel Kiper trying to figure who the next quarterback of this team might be?
Man, trying to guess the draft, I couldn't do it. I mean, you know, even when I was going through the draft myself, I had a myriad of teams lined up, and we really had no idea. And it's like one of those things. You can guess all you want, but you're never going to know until they start rolling out the picks. So, I mean, I could see us, you know, maybe going up front at 4, but, you know, who knows? I don't get to make those calls, so I don't even really bother looking in. But I'm excited whatever happens.
Couple quick things, we'll let you go. And again, we're going to plug this a couple more times. Book drive coming up throughout the month of March, partnering with all Indianapolis area Kroger locations. You can go meet Kylen next Saturday at the one just near the reservoir and by Hamilton Southeastern High School, 116th and Oleo Road. Again, we'll plug that one more time. KGskids.com has more information when you go there. People didn't have a chance to see Drew Ogletree last year because he got hurt early in training camp. You saw it in the workouts all summer long and early in camp. What should fans expect from him? You know, knock on wood, fingers crossed, he has a healthy 2023.
He's a big dude, and he's really athletic for his size. Great in the run game. Great overall, and he picked up, you know, the offense really quick. So once he gets a little experience out there, I think he's going to be ripping and rolling.
Sam Ehlinger obviously got a limited amount of time to show his wares, and I'm not going to have you kind of compare him to, you know, other potential rookie quarterbacks, but I pointed this out earlier. Not only is he your Colts teammate, he's your high school teammate. And even at a powerhouse program that you went to, that doesn't happen where guys got to be high school teammates and then pro teammates. What was that experience like for the both of you last year?
It was definitely a little surreal. Like, hey, man, it was definitely a cool experience. You know, I had someone, I already had like a built-in friend.
Right.
We'd roll in OTAs every morning early. So, you know, we got to develop our friendship. You know, it was just a lot of fun from that aspect. And, you know, we weathered, you know, that season, the rookie season. It's like, dang, we got like 8 more weeks, you know. But, yeah, it was an awesome experience, you know, just getting to know him better. But, yeah, it was a fun time.
All right, so when Colts fans come see you next Saturday at Kroger, 116th and Oleo, what sort of books, what do you want fans to bring to you next Saturday and throughout the month of March?
I mean, bring whatever you can. As long as it's not torn to shreds and you can read it, bring it on up. But we'll take it all.
Kylen, buddy, thanks for your time. Stay healthy this offseason. Look forward to seeing you at the complex real soon. Thanks for the time today.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
You got it. Kylen Granson, again, entering his third year with the Indianapolis Colts. Kind of to join us on the Your Name Here hotline. Again, KGS Kids, KGSKids.com has more information. The book drive will take place at all Indianapolis area Kroger locations starting next Saturday, March 4th, and going all the way through April the 1st. If you want to talk a little Colts, since we've just done that for the last 10 minutes, feel free. We had talked a bit about the Indiana Pacers before that. You can do that too. Well, going into our next break out of the way, our next guest will not join us until 1:30, so there is some time for you to dial us up. Got something you want to say? Now's the time. 317-239-1070. Hit me up on Twitter, at Greg Rakestraw. YouTube chat. I'll kind of peruse that for some comments to share with the rest of the class as well. It's Greg Rakestraw, your host for a second day in a row. Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Hey guys, looking for a reason to spend 3 days on the couch watching basketball? Schedule your vasectomy at Urology of Indiana for a Thursday or Friday, then sit back, relax, and catch some games over the weekend while you recover. It may be the only time your wife approves of hoarding the couch and the remote control. Vasectomies at Urology of Indiana are simple and typically take only about 15 minutes. Soon after, you'll be out the door and on your way home. During your recovery, you'll take ibuprofen and be back to your normal activities in 3 days. The docs at Urology of Indiana are board certified and perform vasectomies every day of the week, all year long. They're pros at what they do, and they have multiple vasectomy clinics, so chances are good there's one close to you. If you've been putting off your vasectomy, now is the time. You'll never have a better excuse to watch basketball. Call Urology of Indiana or visit vasectomyindy.com for information and to schedule an appointment. That's vasectomyindy.com.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in realty. That's Mark Deedle Realty. 317-755-4232. That's online, markdeedle.com, markdeedle.com. Today, whether you're downsizing, maybe you're in for an upgrade, Mark Deedle's going to have all the answers for you because he's going to guarantee an offer in 3 days or he will list it for free. How about Mike and Loretta from Mooresville? The kids were grown, moved out, and they wanted to downsize and move closer to the grandkids. What did they do? They turned it over to Mark Deedle. Mark Deedle got it done right, as he always does. Everybody is happy, and you will be too. The best in realty, it's Mark Deedle. Mark Deedle Realty today. 317-755-4232. That's 317-755-4232. Online, it's markdeedle.com. Do it today. markdeedle.com.
Indianapolis, do you have old, ugly, or even damaged concrete? Not sure what to do about it, but you know you need to do something? Well, you need to call Galaxy Concrete Coatings. This product is out of this world, and it's right here in Indianapolis, and just in time to give your concrete floors a transformation. Galaxy Concrete Coatings is 4 times stronger than epoxy. It's designed to not only work on your garage floor, but you can use it on driveways, walkways, around your pool or patio, commercial or residential. And it's UV resistant, which means it will not yellow. And even better, it can be ready to go in about 24 hours. Click on GalaxyConcreteCoatings.com or call 317-751-9070. Indy, you're ready for a transformation. Call Galaxy Concrete Coatings today, 317-751-9070. Galaxy Concrete Coatings, they are out of this world.
Good morning, sports fans from Indianapolis, Indiana.
This is where heroes become legends, and legends become legendary. This is a special blend of speed.
And Morty Jr. ain't the man, they'll win it!
Tradition.
You just don't know what Indy means.
And magic.
Some of it is London.
This is the Indy 500. But you've never seen this 500. This is May.
Get your tickets now at IMS.com.
A new career offers new beginnings and unlimited opportunities. Begin your career with Eskenazi Health, ranked as Indiana's top hospital for community benefit by the Lown Institute. At Eskenazi Health, our patients are treated with compassion and skill. That's why Eskenazi Health is looking for professionals who share our mission and have a passion for serving their community. Enjoy excellent benefits, competitive pay, and unwavering leadership support. Learn more about Eskenazi Health careers at eskenazihealth.edu/careers.
For victims of drunk and drug driving, your grief is unique, but you are not alone. You always have a place at MAD. Call the 24-hour victim helpline at 877-MAD-HELP or visit MAD.org.
The Ride with JMV.
The new head coach of the Colts, Shane Steichen, joins us. I'm assuming nobody's really going to outwork you in terms of preparation for anything here.
You know, the separation's in the preparation. Every day we come into work, you're on a job interview, and coaches, players, the whole building's got to be locked in at all times, and we got to have a vision for what this thing needs to look like and carry out that vision every single day and be consistent with our message.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Everybody!
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Now we're getting it done, Jimmy. Now we're hitting the sweet spot. He's giving me, see, the camera's only on me, which is not good.
There you go.
Which is not good for anybody.
That's for the radio audience.
But he was giving me the Arsenio Hall dog pound fist pump, which is very apropos for early 1991. They were a three-hit wonder, CNC Music Factory. Greg Rakestraw with you between now and three, a man that appreciates him some CNC Music Factory JMV, follows me at three. He's got a tavern tour stop today, which I think is in my neck of the woods. I think it's in Broad Ripple. Unfortunately, I will not be there. I'm a little busy. I'm doing this here radio show. I've got some work to do for Soccer Saturday tomorrow on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. I also have a stretch of like four games in 26 hours to broadcast, so I got to get to Avon and Danville for a game tonight on ISC and MyIndy TV. And there's the fact that my hometown is pretty much vacant because they're all on their way here because the Lanesville Eagles are playing for a 1A state championship tomorrow in girls basketball, and I am fortunate enough to be on the call of that game on Bally Sports Indiana and the IHSAA Champions Network. So the social calendar has been going since I started my day with the 8 a.m. appearance on Kevin and Query. And it's not going to stop until about 10 or 11 o'clock tonight, and I wouldn't have it any other way. Antoine Davis will be joining us coming up in a matter of moments. But Jimmy wants to talk a little Hoosiers and Boilermakers first. Hello, my friend. How are you?
Hey, Greg, I'm doing great. How are you, my friend?
I'm good. What's up?
Oh, it's great to talk to you. Hey, first off, before I get to my IU-Purdue take, I just wanted to thank you and JMV and Chris Hagan and all the local sports personalities for really, really quenching my thirst for sports. I've been a sports fan ever since I can remember, and you guys have embraced me warmly, so I want to thank you for that, first off, Greg. And real quick, I'm a game tomorrow night. IU at Purdue, obviously. I think it's going to be really important for guys. I'm still torn on who I think is going to win, Greg, honestly. But I think for IU, it's going to be really important for guys like Miller Kopp and the others around Trace Jackson Davis. And this is probably an obvious statement, but I think they really need to show up in that hostile environment tomorrow. And I can't wait for the game, and hope you have a wonderful weekend, Greg. Take care, my friends.
Thank you, Jimmy. And when I was asked about IU earlier this week, I said, Hoosiers probably going to go 0-2 this week. And I don't mean that as like a damning statement, and that shouldn't be a sign that they can't be successful in March. But that's just simply the nature of going to Michigan State and going to Purdue the same week. And again, we talked about this more yesterday and not so much today because we were a day closer to that result at that point in time. I'm not sure anybody goes to Michigan State and wins that game on Tuesday. Given the emotional cauldron that that place was because what happened on that campus the preceding week, whomever Michigan State's first opponent was going to be at the Breslin Center after that was likely not going to be successful. That just happened to be Indiana on that night. And again, if you can go to Purdue and win tomorrow at your biggest rival, when they are one of the best teams in the country, when they are still smarting from you beating them 3 weeks ago, says a lot about this Indiana team. But I'm also not going to sit here and say that Indiana isn't very good because they didn't get the win in that scenario. No, I mean, Purdue's a really good basketball team. And I think Indiana is good. I'm not sure if they're great, which is why I don't have that. I don't have the high expectations for the Hoosiers. I don't think they're going to get run out of the gym by any stretch of the imagination. I think Purdue's going to win that game. And again, Indiana, they're better. They're maybe not as good as we thought they were going to be going into the season. Not as bad as we were worried they were going to be in early January when they couldn't find their way in Big Ten play. They're good. And that's not said to be a backhanded compliment or the negative connotation. They're a good team. They're a top 15 to 20 team. They're a team that with the right matchup can advance far in the NCAA tournament. And they've got two guys in terms of Trace Jackson Davis and Jalen Hood-Schifino that if they get hot, they can hang and they can beat anybody in the NCAA tournament. Indiana is literally going, and everybody is this to some point in time, and Purdue is like this because of Edie, because there's no one like him in college basketball. You know, you've almost got a bucket whenever you need it when he's on the floor for Purdue. Different type of player, obviously, for Indiana, but they've got both Batman and Robin. Question is, can you survive if one of them has an off game? Both of them have an off game, you're going home. But as is the case for so many teams in both the NBA and in college basketball, it is a matchup scenario for Indiana. And where they're going to be seated, they could be sent home the first night. You know, if you're in that 4-5 game, you're getting a 12-13 game, you're getting the best teams of the one-bid leagues, and those are teams, even this era of the transfer portal, where those teams tend to stay together and can make those deep tournament runs. It's why that happens from the 12-13 seed line. Their guys have been teammates for 3 and 4 and 5 years, know exactly where the other one's going to be, and make plays happen. So it's now the realm of possibility that Indiana gets sent home the first night of the tournament. It'd be a huge disappointment. It's not out of the realm of possibility. Indiana is playing in the Elite Eight for the chance to go to a Final Four. And that right there, that is the in-between of college basketball. Like, seemingly the last few years, the formula has been, hey, we look at the number one seeds as being kind of different than anybody else. You know, there's like this group of 3 or 4 or 5 that seemingly separate themselves from everybody else. And those are the teams you're thinking of the likely Final Four contenders. And then there's this group of, say, almost 15 to 20 after that, where you say, hey, if the breaks go their way, if they stay healthy, if a player gets hot, then they're a potential Final Four team. I think Purdue is in that first group. I think Indiana is in that second group. It's possible. It's not guaranteed for either team. Keep your thoughts coming on the subject at Greg Rakestraw on Twitter. You can also email in terms of the chat room at the YouTube link. 107.5 The Fan Live is where you can go to search that and be a part of the conversation. Let me go through some of those in the chat room. From Pete. Pete says this, Rake, no more game day coach interviews with UIndy and USI. They both lost. Yeah, it's part of the reason why I had them on Thursday. In case something went wrong on Thursday night, it wouldn't kind of, you know, affect them in terms of Friday's conversation. But no, it didn't go well for Stan. Didn't go well for Paul last night. And again, for Stan's team, they got to find a way to get a couple of more wins to give themselves some level of postseason play to stay above 500. They got to go on the road at Tennessee State tomorrow. As far as Paul's team is concerned at UIndy, I still think they're okay in terms of getting that number one seed for the Midwest region. They are still very much clear as the number one seed in the GLVC. And the GLVC uses some sort of convoluted points tracker ranking that happened after I was there as a student, and I'm not sure I could explain it. In fact, I know I couldn't explain it, but I saw the rankings after last night's game, and nobody was close to UIndy. So they'll be fine. And they may be able to get by with one more loss and still host that regional, and they have one regular season game and 3 conference tournament games left to go. But, yes, we will check that going forward. I do not want to be a detriment to the guys at either USI or the University of Indianapolis. Yesterday on the show, when you go back and listen to any of those great interviews, you can do so. Go back to the podcast page at 107.5thefan.com. 6 different coaches' interviews that were a part of the show yesterday, and hopefully you can go back and listen to those. And if you have missed any of the interviews today, so far that's been Brandon Gaudin, Jeremiah Johnson, Kylen Granson, waiting on Antoine Davis and Indy 11 head coach Mark Lowry, slated to join us in the 2 o'clock hour of the program. But now, you can join us if you'd like. 317-239-1070 is the telephone number, at Greg Rakestraw on Twitter, and you can email the program too and go old school, greg@1070thefan.com. I'm going to kick back to yesterday on the show because there was a tweet that I never fully had a chance to kind of dive into. We had so many guests on the program yesterday, and this is kind of the juggling act that you do when you're a solo host as a talk show and you're waiting on a guest. You're like, okay, what topics can I get into that I can quickly kind of tie up and wrap up if I need to get back to the guest? So I'm gonna bank that maybe I've got about 5 minutes here before we get our next guest or go to a break where I can hit the PR guy and say, hey, haven't heard from your guy yet. So let me see if I can do this in short order. Brian tweeted this to me yesterday, and he said, if you have time, would love to hear some of your favorites at the high school game, as in all-time team, best atmosphere, gymnasium, student section, PA announcer, band, etc. And was kind enough to say, great show. So let me see if I can do this. All-time team. And I will simply give you the best that I have covered on a regular basis. So me covering high school basketball really has been kind of the last 25 years in the Indianapolis area. So like I was around for the Odin Conley teams. And the way that LN would play that 1-3-1 zone with Conley on the top and Greg on the, and you literally couldn't pass the ball from side to side, LN immediately comes up. I have used this so often with this Ben Davis team that is lined up to compete for a 4A championship this year that is 25-0 going into a final regular season game with Tech tonight. And if they win tonight and if they win their way through the 4A tournament, they'll have the most wins ever in the state of Indiana in an unbeaten season, 33-0. Some team like in the 20s went 34-1. You can't play them any games anymore. 33-0 in an undefeated season is the most wins that anybody would have had. This Ben Davis team reminds me so much of the Warren Central team from 5 years ago, where there wasn't a dominant player, there wasn't a dominant Division I recruit. That team had David Bell now playing in the NFL. Maybe the Zachary kid's playing major college football in the league at some point in time down the road. He is a sophomore. Zane Dowdy's going to play at Valparaiso. Maybe KJ Windham next year is a Division I recruit of that group. Most of those kids are kind of Division II level kids, but they're a phenomenal team. Now, listen, again, all-time team, if I extend it past those that I haven't covered on a regular basis, well, now you're talking about 69 Indianapolis, Washington, and 71 East Chicago, and I forget whether it was Washington or I think it was East Chicago, Washington, 71, the Turgovich Stoddard group that was so ridiculously good. You're getting into Purple Rain of the mid-80s, you know, teams like that. But if you're talking about like the ones that I have seen and the ones that I have covered, three-peat LN mid-2000s, unbeaten Warren in 2018, this Ben Davis team is in the conversation. They have been that good. In terms of best atmosphere, as Antoine Davis is calling the show, I'll skip that one for now. But since you mentioned PA announcer and band, those immediately come to mind. The Addicts band in the 2017 Seymour Semi-State. Like, I still literally start, like, you know, kind of, like, bobbing my head thinking about them playing in that game. The back-to-back semi-state atmospheres in 17 and 18 were absolutely tremendous. Down there, the 1 year it was Castle, Ben Davis, Addicts, Bossy, followed by Morristown, Bar Reeve, obviously the Romeo Langford, and I mean this in a nice way, Circus, as well as Warren Central. Those atmospheres stand out. And my PA announcer, my buddy Aaron Pittman, at Virtual Announce on social. Brian, if time allows, I will get back to that conversation in the next segment. But we do have our next guest. And in a losing effort for Detroit Mercy last night, he scored 27 points, which puts him into double digits away from catching Pete Maravich as the all-time leading scorer in Division I college basketball. He plays for his father, Mike, at Detroit Mercy. Last time I saw him in Indianapolis, he scored 42 points. It is Antoine Davis that joins us now. Antoine, this is Greg. Thank you so much for dialing us up. How you doing this afternoon?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
Of course, buddy. I've seen you play for Detroit Mercy and called your games against IUPUI the last several years, so I know the amount of miles that you put in during the course of the game to run and free yourself off of screens, etc. How you feeling the afternoon after a game last night?
I feel pretty good. Came in earlier and got some treatment and stuff. So just because, you know, we had a quick turnaround. We play again tomorrow at 1 o'clock. And so, you know, just getting the little things done just to make sure that I'm okay and ready to play tomorrow.
We'll talk about numbers up in the thousands in a moment. You wear number 0, and literally it is going to go in the rafters after your game tomorrow. What is it like to be a young man that's going to see his numbered retire while he is still an active player?
Yeah, you know, that's something, it's special. That doesn't happen all the time, you know. So, you know, normally when you get your jersey retired, it's like it takes like 5-10 years maybe, you know, just the amount of time you got to wait to do it. And for me to get it done just after the game is like, it's crazy. It's going to be an emotional this roller coaster for me.
Callahan Hall is a cool old building. And I had the pleasure of, I did one game there about 10 or 12 years ago. What has that court been like to you in terms of a home for the last 5 years?
Oh, I love it. I mean, the stadium, I mean, the campus doesn't look too big, but I mean, you know, the gym is just, is a really big gym in the whole, like, you'd be surprised. You come here and be like, wow, this is actually a really nice arena. And, you know, just enjoyed playing here for 5 years. I'm so happy I never left and transferred and was able to end my career here.
And obviously, you've been through these conversations before. You probably knew what was coming next. Was it ever seriously a thought to kind of break away from dad and go play someplace larger? Was that really ever a thought in your mind?
Yeah, it was. It was a thought. I really thought, like, you know, playing at the next at a higher level with just so I could show that I could do it would work out for me. But I mean, you know, I just felt like it was unfinished business here, and I just really didn't want to end my career anywhere else.
I there's pictures of you as a youngster, as a 2-year-old, you know, your dad holding you at the Final Four as IU's playing in the national championship game. And in your formative years, though, you kind of more remember him as the successful head coach at Texas Southern. If he had stayed there, would you have played for him at Texas Southern as well?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I love the SWAC. I love everything about HBCUs. And I really wanted, like, just seeing it while he was coaching there and me just watching it, just seeing the atmosphere and the love that they show and everything. HBCUs are just really great. I love everything about them. And just I was really excited to play for him there. But then, you know, he got the job at Detroit Mercy. And, you know, they just, Detroit Mercy embraced me so much from the start.
Again, Antoine Davis, he is now less than 100 points away from catching Pistol Pete Maravich as the all-time leading scorer in NCAA history. He plays tomorrow against Wright State. How good is he? They're retiring his jersey at the end of the game. He joins us here on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Again, I can think of you scoring 43 and 42 in two of the games I've called for you playing at the Indiana Farmers Coliseum. When you're going through a game, do you have a tally as to how many points you've scored in your head?
No, I just enjoyed this process and just enjoyed this game so much because, you know, this game can be taken away from you so fast. And, you know, I'm just living in the moment of it. I'm just having fun, just doing what I do best and just winning games from it.
At what point in time was the fact that you would be in the vicinity of possibly catching an all-time great, at what point in time did you kind of realize that, or was that brought to your attention?
You mean we have this big counter, like this big, big counter of the number of how many points I have. So, I mean, I see it all the time. It's talked about on Twitter. I get notifications all the time about it. So, you know, it's always in front of me. I try not to pay too much attention to it and just, you know, just enjoy hooping.
As somebody that has grown up literally around the game, my guess is that while sadly Pete's been gone now for 35 years, I would assume that you've, like, you know, watched some of his old games, seen highlights, YouTube, social media, etc. Have you gone back and studied Pete at this point?
No, I haven't had the chance to, but I used to, in middle school, I used to watch his dribbling videos. Like, you know, he used to do a lot of
right?
introductions and tutorials on what to do, like dribbling, like his stuff that he does dribbling wise. And I used to watch it, and I used to go in my driveway and work on it and just do it and do it over and over and over again. And so it's crazy to think that 11, 12 years ago that I was doing that, and now I'm in the same conversation with him as far as scoring points.
If you do that dribble, you slam that thing as hard as you can down between your legs, and it comes back out the other side, yeah, you got more confidence in your game than I do. I wouldn't be trying that anytime soon.
It ain't nothing you want to keep trying to do, too, especially if you mess up.
All right, exactly. You know you've got two games left, possibly three. Do you potentially do anything different in how you normally play your game, knowing that you're now within 97 points of Pistol Pete?
No, I don't change anything differently. I still just go out and have fun playing this game and just enjoy this. You know, I live in the moment of everything. I never take anything for granted. So, I'm just enjoying this process of playing this game and just, you know, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. You know, I feel like I'm the best scorer of my generation of basketball at the end of the day. So, you know, even if, and then, you know, Pete was the best scorer of his generation.
Obviously, this is not news to you. The two things people will bring up is Pete played 3 years, you played five. And I know from a math standpoint, games canceled for COVID injuries, et cetera, it's really kind of like more like 4.5 for you. And the other thing would be you have 3-point shots, Pete didn't. How do you kind of deal with that, handle that, compartmentalize that, if you will?
People have a narrative about everything. You know, somebody's, you know, it's always going to be something to do with, you know, with whatever. I mean, I'm sure people had something to say, you know, when Bron broke the record or whatever, and then, you know, and everything. But, you know, I mean, you know, Pete, he did it in his generation, you know, with no 3-point line, and then, you know, and with everything he did, I mean, it's just special to do. I mean, I will never take anything away from him from it, because, you know, that's special. You know, and then, you know, I don't shoot 40 shots a game, you know, but, you know, he got the luxury to shoot 40 shots a game.
Sure.
You know, when you're hitting shots and everything, I mean, who's going to say anything to you? If I was on his team, I certainly wouldn't say anything, especially if he's making the shots, you know. So, that's why I feel like I'm the best scorer of my generation. He's the best scorer of his generation of college basketball, because it's just, times are so much different.
Well, I phrase it this way, because I was fortunate to be on the call the day that you went to number 2 on the all-time list, that if nothing else, you were just the best scorer in the last 45 years, because the player that you passed in Williams from Portland State, his last year was 1978. Is tomorrow, and I know it's a tough question to ask, is tomorrow more about, hey, it's my final chance to play, you know, kind of at home and senior day, et cetera, or are you starting to also think about, hey, this is like the one of the last times I get to play for my dad? Is that entered your thought process at all?
You know, just a little bit of both. You know, it's going to be sad to, you know, not play for my dad anymore. You know, just going through this 5 years with him, you know, it's going to be different. You know, I don't know how he's going to deal without me being there, but, you know, we're both going to be a little sad about it. But, you know, I mean, he's let me grow so much as a player and as a leader, and just he's gave me the ability just to lead these guys to reach their best potential of everything. And just he gave me the keys to the car, and he's letting me drive it, and he's letting me, you know, lead these guys as much as possible.
It's been one heck of a ride, and I've enjoyed the conversation, and I'm fortunate if I've called a couple of your games, and you went north of 40 both times. So I know the Indiana Farmers Coliseum has been good to you. I hope for your sake you can win a couple of games and get back here for the semifinals on March 6th and 7th. Tomorrow's going to be a special day for you, buddy. Enjoy it. And thanks for spending some time with us today, Antoine. I greatly appreciate it.
No, yeah, I appreciate you. Anything for, you know, I was born and raised in Bloomington, Indiana. So, you know, anything for, you know, Indiana. I love Indiana so much. I miss it. I miss all my friends back home. So I just really appreciate you taking the time to talk to me.
And tell my buddy PJ I said hello and thank you, okay?
I sure will.
You got it. That's PJ Gradowski, by the way, that is the PR contact for Detroit Mercy. Help set that up. Antoine Davis joining us, and first time he and I have had a chance to have a conversation. I have called his games before, but we've never had a chat until just now. And again, I will acknowledge, Pete played 3 years. This kid was a part of 5 seasons. Pete didn't have the 3-point line. This kid does. Antoine pointed out a very good point. He's taken a lot less shots in his time than Pete has as well. There, if he catches Pistol Pete, if he can score 98 points in two games, three games, how many ever left for Detroit Mercy is going to happen? There always has to be a difference in the eras and a comparison of the two. But the way he said it is very well. I think I'm the best scorer of my generation. Goodness, kid, the numbers would back that up. He has north of 3,500 career points. It's pretty doggone special. So that's something to kind of follow next week. Detroit Mercy right now is eighth in the Horizon League standings. As it stands now, they would get a home game against Purdue Fort Wayne next Tuesday. That will all change tomorrow afternoon. And this shameless plug, I'll have the IUPUI call against Youngstown State tomorrow night at the Jungle downtown at 7 o'clock. And you can watch it on ESPN+. We are late for a break. Let me take care of that. Then we'll come back with some quick thoughts. Mark Lowry at 2 o'clock. Podcast of that available soon. 1075thefan.com. We're back after this.
Did your health club just eliminate basketball? Pickup USA Fitness invites you to take a look. $99 initiation fee cut to $50 if you act now. PickupUSAFitness.com.
Dan Dockage for Affinity Whole Health, the leader in testosterone therapy. They've got me on a testosterone program. Got to tell you, I feel amazing. Get started at FeelGreatIndy.com. That's FeelGreatIndy.com.
Window Nation has the coolest deal ever for keeping you warm. Get two windows free with every two you buy with zero down payment, zero monthly payments, and pay zero interest for 24 months. Now is the perfect time to take advantage of Window Nation's deep discounts, all while reinvesting in your biggest asset. Not to mention, the savings on your energy bills for years to come, up to 43% of your home utility bill goes to heating and cooling. With new Window Nation windows, you can cut those energy bills during these cold winter months by keeping your hot air in and the cold air outside. Go with the window company that has installed over 1 million windows in over 150,000 homes, all with 96% customer satisfaction. Now is the time to upgrade the look and feel of your home, all while saving thousands on your energy bills. Call 866-90-NATION and get two windows free with every two you buy with no limit, plus make no down payment, no payments, and pay no interest for 24 months. This offer won't last long. Call Window Nation today, 866-90-NATION, or go to windownation.com. Tell them Kevin Bowen sent.
To everyone who believes in tradition, let our team member Caitlin share one that's been at the heart of Culver's since the beginning.
In Wisconsin, we love a good fish fry, like really love. And bringing friends and family together over a fresh meal is how we've always done it at Culver's. It's why we still hand batter our North Atlantic cod to order and cook it to crispy, golden perfection. Sharing our Wisconsin favorites with all of you, that's what really makes our day.
Come to Culver's and get a taste of our fish fry tradition.
From Wisconsin with love,
welcome to Delicious. To everyone who needs a little delight in their day, let our team member Paul tell you about one of our favorite sweet treats.
Making special moments at mealtime is a tradition in Wisconsin. And what better way to sweeten your day than a blue spoonful of a Culver's Concrete Mixer? We handcraft our fresh frozen custard with your favorite mix-ins, so every bite is exactly the way you like. From caramel to your favorite candies like crispy, crunchy Butterfinger.
Come to Culver's and let us make your day a little bit sweeter. From Wisconsin with love, welcome to Delicious.
Finding great candidates to hire can be like, well, trying to find a needle in a haystack. Sure, you can post your job to some job board, but then all you can do is hope the right person comes along, which is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you. Its powerful technology identifies people with the right experience and actively invites them to apply to your job. You get qualified candidates fast. So while other companies might deliver a lot of hay, ZipRecruiter finds you what you're looking for. The needle in the haystack.
4 out of 5 employers who post a job on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate through the site within the first day. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And right now you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free. Just go to this exclusive web address, ziprecruiter.com/free. That's ziprecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter.com/free.
JMV here with an exclusive scoop on how you can attend the NFL Combine for free. Get inside Lucas Oil Stadium to see future NFL stars up close. At the Combine Experience, you can pass, punt, and run. To attend for free, March 2nd through the 5th, just go to visitindy.com/combine to sign up for free tickets and parking. The NFL Combine up close with the best college football has to offer, March the 2nd through the 5th. Get your free tickets at visitindy.com/combine. See you there.
guys. The party tonight is at Dancer Show Club on West Washington Street. Dancers is Indy's premier gentleman's club. It's just minutes from downtown, the airport, and the track, so you're never far from the action. Three main stages, the most entertainers, sports on the big screens, bottle service, weekly specials on food and drink, and 8,000 square feet of fun. Bachelor parties, divorce parties, birthday parties, whatever the occasion, the party is at Dancer Show Club. Open till 3 a.m. 7 days a week. DancerShowClub.com.
On the podcast, The Last Soviet, Lance Bass from NSYNC shares his own experiences of astronaut training in Russia. Yes, that's true. And tells the story of the final cosmonaut, a man trapped in space while his nation crumbled to the ground.
His name is Sergei Krikalev. He's a Soviet cosmonaut, and he's manning the world's only space station, the pride and joy of the USSR.
Listen to The Last Soviet wherever you get your podcasts.
Puccini's 707 location. Puccini's Pizza Pasta.com. Puccini's 707 location. Puccini's Pizza Pasta.com.
Founded right here in Indianapolis in 1991 and winner of the World Pizza Championships in Parma, Italy.
Puccini's 707 location. Puccini's Pizza Pasta.com.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan.
Jimmy has found the sweet spot. 1990-1991's best tracks. That may be the soundtrack then for the remainder of the program. Antoine Davis was fantastic. And that ended up being a plug for the Horizon League tournament. My friends in the Horizon League office, I'm sure, will appreciate that. A week from this coming Monday and Tuesday, four games on Monday, two games on Tuesday. I know I can do this because I've heard the spots on this radio station. So I think I can kind of add that into the mix. Women's tournament games in the afternoon, men's tournament games in the evening. You want to get your college basketball fix? It's a good way to do it here in Indianapolis, as this is the rare year without Big Ten tournament games taking place here in the Circle City. HorizonLeague.com/Indy has more, and maybe, just maybe, you'll see a young man attempt to break Pete Maravich's scoring record. I know some of the chats and the YouTubers are going about it, and again, what Maravich did in 3 years is absolutely jaw-dropping to average the points that he did. Simply the fact that somebody got close to that record is remarkable to me. He's within 97 points with a guarantee of two games left to play, and then whatever else he could do from a conference tournament standpoint, because the Titans are 13-17. So if they're going to make the postseason, they're going to have to win the whole darn thing to get to the NCAA tournament, or not NCAA tournament, but to get to any postseason basketball at all, because you don't have to be over above 500 to even play in like the secondary and tertiary and third and fourth level tournaments that they offer after the NCAA and after the NIT. Brandon Gaudin, Jeremiah Johnson, Kylen Granson, Antoine Davis, all available on the podcast page at 1075thefan.com. 2:30 and on, and frankly, probably before that, that's all you. I've got one more guest coming your way, and normally he and I talk for Soccer Saturday, and I'll warn you now, you'll hear this conversation again tomorrow on Soccer Saturday as well. But Mark Lowry is the head coach of the Indy 11. They are 2 weeks away from starting their season. Even though his focus is the team and what happens on the pitch, I'm sure he's going to want to talk about that new stadium announcement that was made last Friday morning as well. He and I will catch up on that and other things when we come back. It's Greg Rakestraw, Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
It's Kevin and Querry.
Tyrese Halliburton joining us here.
I'm a Midwest kid through and through. It's in my blood. For me, it's just about winning basketball games. You know, the Pacers are a first-class organization who have done that, and the fans have been so awesome for us. We're coming into the year, a lot of people consider it a rebuild. Our fans have showed out every night, showed up to the games, showed love, showed support, and I think that means the world to us as young guys, because we know when we really get things cracked that our fan base will really be crazy.
Kevin and Querry.
Weekday mornings at 7
on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
I don't want to go to bed at night dreading waking up in the morning, knowing that I'm going to feel like a rusty lawn chair getting out of bed and getting opened up and not being able to really move for a couple hours really throughout the day.
For former college and pro football player Bobby Carpenter and those dealing with daily aches and pains, QC Kinetics regenerative pain treatments are a game changer, providing long-lasting relief.
Go into a specific joint, a specific region, and then help promote that healing process using your own body's mechanisms to heal. I mean, that's been something that's pretty powerful, and there's no surgery, there's no downtime.
QC Kinetics natural treatments help the body heal and restore itself. No more rusty lawn chair.
It's no surprise to see people being willing to try this first, especially when it has such great results.
Pain relief the natural way. QC Kinetics. Call today for your complimentary consultation. Find out if you're a good candidate for treatment.
Call QC Kinetics 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN. Pain.
Welcome to Northern Indiana's premier hotel entertainment experience. Escape, indulge, and relax. Dine at the new Edgewater Restaurant and schedule something unforgettable at Ribbentown Event Center. Here, where gaming, award-winning cuisine, and the entertainment experience of your life are waiting just for you. The new Four Winds Casino Hotel opening March 1st. Schedule your escape today at the new Four Winds Casino Hotel in South Bend. Visit fourwindscasino.com.
By now, you know that sound. It's the sound of the Home Depot. But what about those sounds? Those are the sounds of a new Frigidaire kitchen suite, complete with the latest technology to keep food fresh, dishes clean, and cooking needs met for all families. Making this the sound of savings on top brand appliances. The Home Depot, how doers get more done. Final days to get up to 25% off select appliances, including Frigidaire, ends March 1st. Offer valid February 9th through March 1st, 2023. U.S. only, see store online for details.
Hey, it's Dan Dockage for Affinity Whole Health. Guys, do something for yourselves. Go to feelgreatindy.com. I'm on a testosterone replacement program with Affinity. Let me tell you, the benefits are amazing. Go to feelgreatindy.com. That's feelgreatindy.com.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The IHSAA Girls Basketball State Finals. Tomorrow morning at 11 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Back home again. 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Now, see, I'm kind of like Pavlov's dog. I hear this song and it gives me a reaction. It's like I need to be doing 2 hours of soccer play-by-play. It's go time when I hear this song. This is what was played about 2 minutes before a match starts at Carroll Stadium. First chance to experience that will be 5 weeks from tomorrow. Indy 11's home opener against the Las Vegas Lights is on April the 1st. The season starts in 2 weeks in St. Petersburg at Al Lang Stadium against the always good Tampa Bay Rowdies. The Indy 11 head to Chicago for a preseason friendly against the Chicago Fire, open their MLS season this weekend. That comes up tomorrow. And kind of join us the day before is the head coach of the Indy 11 in Mark Lowry. Hello, my friend. How are you?
Hey, Greg. It's good to be back on with you, and we're feeling pretty good right now. Looking forward to season starting.
Well, obviously, we'll talk about your team in a matter of moments. And again, for the Indy 11 fans listening, some of this is going to be remedial because we're broadcasting to a larger audience on the Fans Midday Show today. But let's talk about the biggest thing that has happened since you and I last spoke 2 weeks ago, and that is the reveal of the stadium. And clearly, you're focused on building the team and winning with the players you have, but to be working with an organization that has that in its future, what does that mean to you and your job?
Yeah, it's exciting, and it was one of the things that was kind of spoke to me when I took this job just over a year ago now. This obviously been in the works for a while. That's no secret. I think the fans would have liked it sooner.
Sure.
I always believed that the club was going to get this done. It's one of the reasons why I was happy to come here, because I could see the future. And with that stadium, and not just the stadium, the whole development right around the stadium, it's going to improve downtown, it's improving the whole community, and it's going to give a lot to the public, not just soccer, but various outlets.
For those that don't follow the Indy 11, the guy that is the head coach at our level, USL Championship, is largely the guy that is the one heading up free agent recruitment and player transactions and movement and things like that. Is this now to the point where that's a recruiting chip for you going forward?
Yeah, 100%. Everybody's aware of it. It kind of spread like wildfire around the league and through social media, obviously, that this is what it's going to look like. And when you have a building like that, it's definitely easy to bring players in because people want to play in a stadium like that.
All right, so let's now talk about your team. Three preseason matches in, two left to go. Last time out was against the Chicago Fire, two of MLS Next. Your guys played awfully well. How are you feeling about what you've seen from your team in preseason so far?
Yeah, really good. The last two, 3 weeks have been fantastic. The development of the group, the progression they've shown has been superb. We knew we were bringing in good players this year, so the talent was not in question. But it's easier said than done, right? The game's not played on paper, right? You have to come together. There has to be a way of doing things. The players have to buy in. They have to go into work. And there has to be that cohesiveness. And I think the last couple of weeks, we've really seen that. And the guy's been fantastic, and it's reflected in the score lines. Even though it's preseason, we were not too worried about the score. It is nice to score goals, it's nice to win. I've never hid that fact. But the way they played in those games has been really pleasing.
All right, you've got two more preseason games left. Your lone road one is coming up tomorrow again against the Chicago Fire. Again, kind of a split squad. Obviously, their main guys playing for the MLS weekend. Then you guys playing against kind of the reserves. I think that's the case. Educate me if I'm incorrect about that. And then you got forward Madison that will come to town next Friday, who plays in League One. Again, I know your concern is more your team than the other guys you're playing, but what do you want to see from your guys these next 2 weeks in terms of ramping up to get to the season opener?
Yeah, well, interesting. The reason why we're playing Chicago Fire tomorrow is because they have a bye.
They're the one team opening weekend, huh?
So we're actually going up against
their
first team squad. Yeah, exactly. So it suits them because they need a game, and it gives us high quality opposition. So it's an exciting game for us. I mean, we're going to be going up against their first team, and there'll be some quality players in the field, so it's a really good test for us to see where we're at. I know we're excited to get up there, play away, play on grass, play outside, play against the MLS team, and all those things are exciting for us. And then the following week, Madison will provide a stern test. I mean, USL League One, but those USL League One teams, they're blue-collar, they're organized, they're physical, they're hard-working, so it's going to be a nice a test for us leading into Tampa on March 11th.
Again, Mark Lowry, head coach of the Indy 11, our guest Greg Rakestraw with you, Fan Midday Show, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Again, the Indy 11 audience, even the new players, they know the guys by heart. For this bigger audience we're broadcasting to today, if there is a new face that general sports fans around Indianapolis need to know about your team, that guy would be whom?
It's a good question because we've brought in some pretty big names this year, guys that have all-league the last few years and are well-known throughout, the soccer landscape. But I understand not everyone in Indianapolis follows the USL or Indy 11. So I think the one guy that's interested in them is Cam Lindley because he's a local kid.
Sure.
Born and raised in Carmel, Indiana, played for U.S. national teams growing up, got drafted into MLS by Orlando City, played in MLS. So but he's come back home this year. He wants to raise his family back here in Indiana. His wife is pregnant and she's due very soon.
Yes.
So it's really exciting to have him back. He's excited to be back. So I think that can kind of connect with the community, right? We want to bring guys back here that represent their hometown, and if they're good enough, we'll definitely try and do that.
So have you had the conversation with Cam? Hey, listen, buddy, the season opener is March 11th. If Olivia hasn't had the baby by a certain date, you might want to set inducement for March 6th or 7th at this point.
Yeah, we joke about let's get a move on, right? We're going up on the bus tomorrow, Chicago. He's going to drive himself in case he has to come back because we're days away from his little girl being here. So, it's exciting for him. We obviously prefer it to happen before the season starts. But hey, look, I tell the guys all the time: your husband's first,
yep.
Your father's first, you're a person first. Enjoy those moments, right? The game's always here for you. So do what you need to do as a father and a husband.
You and I have had this conversation before. Again, you love, frankly, your top kind of top 15, top 16. I know you're still looking for kind of maybe one more piece or two with the season 2 weeks away. How is that process coming along?
Yeah, it's moving. It's moving in the right direction. Because we're so happy with the 16-17 that we have, we don't need to panic on these final two pieces. It's afforded us time to be patient, to get it right, to make sure we round out the roster in the right way. But we are looking at two additional pieces at either end of the field, in the back line and then in the attacking department. And really, if I could explain, you know, who those would be, it would be just something different to what we currently have. I like to have a few different plans up my sleeve. If something's not working, it's nice to mix it up and maybe throw a bigger guy on the field if you want to go a little bit more aerial. So
yep.
We're just looking for two pieces that can kind of throw a curveball in there, kind of mix it up for us when we need to, and a little bit different to what we currently have. But like I said, we're so happy with the group right now. We can afford to take our time, make sure we get it right.
Obviously, your focus is on the Chicago Fire for tomorrow. Then it's 2 weeks out, again, in terms of the match opener against Tampa Bay. Week off, then Detroit. So I'm hitting fast forward a little bit here. But for the most part, there'll be the dedicated fans that will make the trip to St. Pete. And there'll be a lot of fans from here that make the short drive to Hamtramck to watch you play in a great atmosphere at Keyworth up on March 25th. But for the most part, people that are listening, the first chance they would have to see your team in person would be in 5 weeks when you open on April the 1st. For, again, a sports fan who's not a soccer person, when they come watch your team on April the 1st, what do you want them to see and observe about your team?
You know, I think first and foremost, I'd like them to feel the energy around the stadium, you know, just the general atmosphere that we get at our games. If you can kind of sit yourself close to BYB, which is our supporters group, you know, get as close to them as possible, you'll really feel the energy and the smoke and the excitement and the singing and that energy is pretty, you know, addictive. Once you feel that, you kind of want to come back for more. And then on the field, a team that kind of reflects that, plays quality, plays with energy. You know, we like to have the ball. We're a team this season that's going to dominate the ball. So hopefully we'll be the team that's attacking a lot and we can entertain you. But I think when you come to our game, particularly a home opener, if you come, the stadium's going to be full. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be energetic. And it's going to make you want to come back.
That is always the case. My friend, always appreciate the time. Safe travels to Chicago. I'll see you next week out at Grand Park.
Thanks, Greg. Take care.
You got it. Again, Mark Lowry, head coach of the Indy 11, kind enough to join us. And again, shame on me for not knowing Chicago Fire weren't playing. There's 29 teams in Major League Soccer this year with the addition of St. Louis. So one team gets the bye, and that team just happens to be the Indy 11. So they will get the primary players for the Chicago Fire. I'm sure they'll kind of sub out some sides throughout the course of the match. But that just got a little more interesting from my perspective tomorrow. Again, Indy 11 have one more preseason friendly. Maybe they let season ticket holders in. I'm not sure. I snuck out to the one. I called the game against Indiana Wesleyan, which was cool. We've never done a preseason stream before. Did that on Valentine's Day. I then went up and just watched the first half of the Butler match on February the 10th. And I think time allows me to at least get a good first half viewing of the match against Ford Madison next Friday. Indy11.com, 317-685-1100. Because you are quite soccer knowledgeable, both as a fan and as someone that doesn't mind making some money off of a money line when it comes to soccer. Mr. Cook, questions you might have about the Indy 11, about the new stadium. I am much more knowledgeable on the team than I am the new digs, but fire away with your Indy 11 questions for me while we have the opportunity.
Well, I guess one on the, I guess, team/fan engagement side, yep. If people are still looking into season tickets, is that still a possibility, or is that...
We will happily take your money whenever you would like. We can always pull back tarps for more tickets if we need to. Indy11.com, 317-685-1100. Yes.
You mentioned the fact that it's going to be some first team experience against MLS club in the Chicago Fire tomorrow. From your preparation standpoint and just how a team like this can build off of that, with the season, like you said, or the home opener anyway, 5 weeks away.
This is all, again, the teams at the top end of our league, of which we hope and aspire to be this year after, frankly, not being that the last 2 years, there's not a huge difference between, say, a back-end MLS team and a top-flight USL championship team in terms of talent. Not like they're going to play the Indy 11 off the pitch. I can't remember whether it was last year or the year before
that I think we ended up playing Vancouver in a preseason friendly and beat them. And let's be honest, from a score standpoint, Butler beat the Indy 11 3-1. You see it in preseason baseball, spring training. Sometimes the college team beats the pro team. It happens. But in theory, barring a U.S. Open Cup run, which was the only time in a competitive match we've truly played the Chicago Fire, that'll be the best team we see all year. So it does nothing but help you get better. Think of it. It's a very, to me, apples-to-apples comparison. Think about a D2 team playing a D1 team in a preseason college basketball game in early November. Sometimes the D2 team wins, and so that's certainly possible. But, no, it's a great opportunity.
You and I jokingly laughed for the pain at times last year of kind of a growth year for the 11. Where are your expectations for them, and where should the fan base's expectations be this season?
All right, so 12 teams in each conference, 8 teams make the playoffs. We should definitely be a playoff team. Indy 11 is significantly better. Now, there are some really good operations and really good teams in our side. Lou City is the best football, as in soccer, operation outside of Major League Soccer. It almost pains me to say it because of the rivalry, but it's absolutely the truth. They have been around for 8 years. I think they've made the conference final at least every year and won a couple of championships. And they were very much about building from within, and they still do that and retain a lot of players. They have been much more apt the last couple of 3 years to go out and sign the best free agents available. For example, Dylan Maris from Zionsville has played for the Indy 11 in a couple of different stints. One of our all-time leaders in matches played after playing for Mark Lowry in El Paso for a couple of years and playing for El Paso last year. Dylan's wearing the purple this year and has joined a very good team in Lou City. Tampa Bay, we've got a couple of their former players on our team now. Sebastian Guenzada, we traded for Juan Tejada last year. They've lost some key pieces, but they're always going to be good. That's whom we open with in a couple of weeks. Birmingham went out and got one of our best former players in Tyler Pascher. After 2 years in Major League Soccer, he's now playing for the Birmingham Legion. They're good. Detroit City had a great year last year. I'm not sure if they can maintain that, although their head coach, former Indy 11 assistant Trevor James, is really good. I'm leaving somebody out, but I'm spacing. Charleston did a great job. They were the worst team in our half of the league last year. They're going to be much better with Ben Pearman. I think Memphis without Pearman will come back to the pack a little bit. I'm literally like scrolling through every team in my head in the Eastern Conference, but we should be a playoff team, and I will tell you as the year goes along, I think we can compete with the top teams in the Eastern Conference. Time will tell.
I know we probably don't want to get too much in the weeds with this, but from a broad standpoint, soccer is a game that requires patience, depending on your style in terms of scoring. From a scoring standpoint, a pace standpoint, how will the 11 be in that regard this year?
Well, it's funny, and everybody in soccer, shouldn't say everybody, more and more teams are playing a high press. And again, for those of you that are not of the soccer persuasion, there's a lot of things from a soccer movement and how you move the ball, albeit hands versus feet. But I've often told people that are wanting to get more into soccer, but maybe have more of a basketball background, folks, you're trying to score against a 2-3 zone. That's exactly what soccer tends to be. So when I say high press, it is very similar to a full court press in basketball. In other words, the analytics of the game, soccer, because of the way it's played, the amount of players on the field, the somewhat random nature of it, seemingly has been the last sport to embrace the analytics revolution. But it is here. And the analytics tell you something that once you think about it, you go, well, duh, that makes common sense. And that is, if you force a team to turn it over or put the ball in a bad situation, probably best to do that as close to your goal as possible. How do you do that? By pressing high, contesting every ball along the back line, and then the team screws up, you got a better chance of scoring a goal because of that screw up, as compared to taking it 75 yards and then trying to score with it in that direction. So I say that, Jimmy, for this reason. Most teams now are high-pressing teams. The Indy 11, with the diamond system they use, it's all about trying to run you ragged and have you make that mistake. In theory, that's a system that nets you 2, 3, 4 goals a game, and that's certainly the way the Indy 11 want to play. I hope I didn't get too deep into the weeds with that.
Last question on my end for the casual fan or somebody just trying to get into soccer. And I know that you and I would make the argument, well, any game you want to be out there, see the Indy 11 is going to be a fun time, but maybe one or two games you have circled as must-see regular season tilts on the calendar.
Sure. Race day, as in race weekend, I should say, which will be the usually there's the checkered kits day or the racing Indy day. That would be May 27th, and Lou City is the opponent. So we have jokingly said it's the Derby on Derby Day. We played a couple of those before here. Louisville's coming up for race weekend, and so that one will be great. And it will be great in part because Lou City will bring a lot of fans with them. And Indy, they, we are the noisy neighbors when we go down to Lou City. We get these looks. You guys are mean. Yeah, we are a little bit. We want to beat you. That's kind of the idea. When we go down there. So May 27th is one that immediately comes to mind. But obviously, Jimmy, all 17 home dates are glorious. Oh, yeah. And you can find out more at Indy11.com. But off the top of my head, immediately, that's the one that comes to mind. Great questions, by the way. We might need to make the Jimmy Cook, Greg Rakestraw Q&A like a weekly segment on Soccer Saturday.
Sounds fun to me.
Makes it much easier for me. All right, folks, the rest of the show, it is you and me. I've got something of the Joey Votto take that I wasn't planning on having today, but it hit my timeline and I go, I think I could talk about that. But simply put, the rest of the show is up to you. Believe me, I've got plenty of things I could talk about. But if you want to talk more Hoosiers and Boilers, great. You want to talk more Pacers? We can do that too. We had Colts conversation with Kylen Granson. All of those things are up for you. But knowing that when I'm in this chair, what are the two things we often come back to? Well, one of them you just heard for the last 18 minutes in terms of talking soccer. I'm the soccer guy, especially from, say, like April through August. I'm the soccer guy. Then when it comes to, say, August through March, I'm the high school guy. So since the girls' high school state finals are tomorrow and I'm broadcasting two of those games, and clearly I'm attached to one of the teams that is playing in those games tomorrow, we can have that conversation. But also, boys sectional week is next week. I had a great Twitter question about a sectional to go to yesterday, and the folks in sectional 9 have loved my answer because they've been retweeting it for the last 24 hours since. So if those two things are of interest to you, now's the time, because it's open phone lines the rest of the way. 317-239-1070 at Greg Rakestraw on Twitter. Heck, if you know the bat phone, text me here and I'll talk about that too. Me and you for the next 40 minutes on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
To everyone who believes in tradition, let our team member Caitlin share one that's been at the heart of Culver's since the beginning.
In Wisconsin, we love a good fish fry, like really love. And bringing friends and family together over a fresh meal is how we've always done it at Culver's. It's why we still hand batter our North Atlantic cod to order and cook it to crispy, golden perfection. Sharing our Wisconsin favorites with all of you, that's what really makes our day.
Come to Culver's and get a taste of our fish fry tradition.
From Wisconsin with love,
welcome to Delicious. To everyone who needs a little delight in their day, let our team member Paul tell you about one of our favorite sweet treats.
Making special moments at mealtime is a tradition in Wisconsin. And what better way to sweeten your day than a blue spoonful of a Culver's Concrete Mixer? We handcraft our fresh frozen custard with your favorite mix-ins, so every bite is exactly the way you like. From caramel to your favorite candies like crispy, crunchy Butterfinger.
Come to Culver's and let us make your day a little bit sweeter. From Wisconsin with love, welcome to Delicious.
Indianapolis, do you have old, ugly, or even damaged concrete? Not sure what to do about it, but you know you need to do something? Well, you need to call Galaxy Concrete Coatings. This product is out of this world, and it's right here in Indianapolis, and just in time to give your concrete floors a transformation. Galaxy Concrete Coatings is 4 times stronger than epoxy. It's designed to not only work on your garage floor, but you can use it on driveways, walkways, around your pool or patio, commercial or residential. And it's UV resistant, which means it will not yellow. And even better, it can be ready to go in about 24 hours. Click on GalaxyConcreteCoatings.com or call 317-751-9070. Indy, you're ready for a transformation. Call Galaxy Concrete Coatings today, 317-751-9070. Galaxy Concrete Coatings, they are out of this world.
to my newborn baby boy. The day you arrived was one of the happiest days of my life. Right up there with the day I bought my RV from that guy on the internet and insured it with Progressive. What a deal. Just know, son, I'll always be here for you. And by here, I mean in the middle of absolutely nowhere. In my RV.
Protect your baby with an RV policy from Progressive. Take as little as 4 minutes to see what you could save at Progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates.
Celebrate National Margarita Day at Twin Peaks, February 22nd, with the best margarita lineup in the game. What's your go-to style? House, Peaks, Watermelon, Illegal Mezcal, or On the Rocks? And Twin Peaks has you covered with Lent Bundles kickoff February 24th. Try the fish and chips bundled with a 22-ounce draft for a steal on Fridays. Or reel in one of the other seafood options like blackened fish tacos, shrimp Caesar, and char-grilled salmon.
Twin Peaks. Eats, drinks, scenic views.
Hey, it's Dan Dockage here. You know, for years on my radio show, I asked people to help me out. I needed a treatment. Aches and pains. I couldn't lose weight. Well, guess what? I found a solution. I did. Affinity Whole Health. All you've got to do is go to feelgreatindy.com and look into it for yourself. The testosterone program that I am on has been a godsend. I've missed no workouts in 6 months. No more aches and pains. And I have lost weight. FeelGreatIndy.com is the place to go. Get started just like I did.
What if the next time you painted your home was the last time you painted your home?
Our Rhino Shield has been on for 8 years.
Rhino Shield. Call 888-RHINO-41.
Don't paint, don't vinyl. Go Rhino!
The Ride with JMV.
Matt Painter, the head coach of the Boilermakers. Is there a vital piece that you look for just outside of athleticism, talent, and the basketball package there?
Yeah, winning is what I look for. You know, you get in high school and like, you know, you're just more talented than people, but do you have winning ways about you? You know, are you a competitor? When things don't go your way, how do you and the people around you, you know, react?
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Goes a little something like this. Tag team back again. Check it to wreck it. Let's
begin. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Oh, the song that you loved and became annoying quickly in 1993. And now, because of sprinkles and it was a Geico commercial, became okay again for a while. This will be replaced by Two Unlimited. Get ready for this, like 2 years later, by the way, as the way too suburban hip hop track of the year, by the way. Greg Rakestraw, thanks to Jimmy Cook, the brains of the operation over the course of the last couple of days. Who's in on Monday? I have no idea. Won't be me. Been fun to hang with you for a couple of days, but you can always catch my work at iscsportsnetwork.com or simply put a high school gym close to you. I'm probably going to be there, at least for the next 2 or 3 weeks. Toby on the phone lines wants to talk Colts trade scenarios. I'm down with that. Hello, Toby.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good, sir.
Yeah, I got two of them. The first one is it conceivable that they could trade to the Bears Ryan Kelly and 23, I'm trying to think of his name.
Kenny Moore. Yep.
Or Shaq Leonard for the first pick and still keep the fourth pick?
No. No way. I mean, I think if you trade veterans, what you potentially avoid is more picks further down the draft. But there is no scenario, again, given all of the needs that the Chicago Bears have, there's no scenario where they would not get a high draft pick back. In other words, I could see the Bears trading with the Texans at 2. To get, you know, so that way the Texans could guarantee they get the quarterback that they want. The Colts obviously making a move in terms of getting from 4 to 1 to get the quarterback they want. I don't see the Cardinals. I think the Cardinals own, they've got Kyler Murray, and you can, you know, there's question marks there, obviously, but he's going to be their quarterback next year. I think the Cardinals are content to say, you know what, you guys move around. We'll get the non-quarterback that we want or a player that we want at 3. But no, if the Bears are making a trade, they're going to get a pick top 4, top 5 back for this year's draft.
Okay. Let me throw one other scenario at you.
Yep.
What would the Colts get if they traded down from the 4th pick to, say, between 10 and 15? What could they get if they traded down to that And then at that level, they pick Hendon Hooker out of Tennessee.
The Colts would get a nice haul back. What they'd also get is a potential fan riot. Chris Ballard should not concern himself with what the fans want. Okay. You can't, yeah. There's a line that if you coach or you manage a team by way of the fans, pretty soon you'll be sitting with them. So you can't do that. At the same time, I think you have to take the temperature of the room and realize, dude, you've got to get your guy, you know, early in the draft. And there is a difference between the top-rated quarterback and the second-rated quarterback and the third-rated quarterback and the fourth-rated quarterback and on down to five, a guy that you would mention of that ilk. So, I know Chris has a propensity to trade down. I get that. I don't think that's the time for it. I think now is the time to go up.
Okay.
Toby, thanks for the phone call, but I appreciate you listening. I appreciate you dialing us up. 317-239-1070 if you want to be a part of the conversation. I saw on Twitter Nate Atkins and Joel Erickson, who cover the team, obviously, for the Indianapolis Star, both kind of saying that earlier today, and kind of that way I have phrased it. And I'm not sitting here, and maybe 2 months from now when I have studied the guys more, I will say that Bryce Young is your guy, or C.J. Stroud is your guy, or Levis or Rich, whatever. I'm not there yet. I am saying this much more of kind of like the generic standpoint of, if there's a guy that you feel is your guy, go get him. Go get him to get that guy at number one, whether that's Young, whether that's Stroud, whatever the case may be. But, you know, the Colts, thankfully, have been in this position. In one sense, I want to say so infrequently, because they drafted Nelson at 6. The last, and then, you know, you got to go back to Luck at 1 in 2012, the last time you were anywhere close to that scenario. But yet you'd also say, hey, if you potentially get yourself to the number one pick take quarterback 3 times in 25 years or 4 times in 30 years, not many franchises have that opportunity either. We've had that. I'm throwing Jeff George in, by the way, in 90 in talking about that argument there. You could obviously talk about different levels of success in terms of drafting at that number one position. But I am much more of the, I want the elevator going up in terms of a trade, not the elevator going down. That's just me. Steve wants to talk on this subject. Hello, Steve.
Hi, how are you, Greg? I really enjoy listening to you and appreciate your knowledge.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that.
I haven't heard this anywhere. Is there any interest or thought into looking at Green Bay's Jordan Love? Since if Aaron Rodgers comes back, this guy's been on the bench for
sure.
4 or 5 years.
Sure.
And that way we wouldn't get rid of all our other good players. I mean, we'll have to replace whatever players we give up to move up. It just doesn't seem to make sense.
That is a... It's an outside possibility, and I think Love is in his second year or his third, which would mean he would have 2 or 3 years left on his rookie deal. And I've lost track of exactly how many years he's been on the pine collecting dust at this point. And he is the guy, maybe because of the region of the country that he played in or the way that he played, is almost seemingly like the Josh Allen guy. Like, hey, you're not sure what you have in him, but you've got something. Steve, honestly believe if the Green Bay Packers were completely honest with you, they would prefer that Jordan Love is their quarterback next year and that Aaron Rodgers goes someplace else. I think there is an acknowledgement of how great Aaron Rodgers has been in Green Bay. I think there is also kind of a tiredness or simply an acknowledgement of, hey, it's been 16 great years. It's time for us to go in a different direction. Thank you, and let's move on. So would I be interested in a Jordan Love scenario here? I might be. Could you get him for less than, say, the number 4 pick in the draft? Yes, you could. Honestly, I think he's the starting quarterback in Green Bay. I think Rodgers is going someplace else, to be honest with you, Steve.
Okay, well, thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Steve, thanks for calling us up. I appreciate you. Keep those Colts phone calls coming or tweets if you'd like as well. At Greg Rakestraw on Twitter, email the program, Greg at 1070 The Fan, or dial us up at 317-239-1070. Phone calls this segment and the next. The other thing that I will share with you, and again, I really hadn't planned on talking about the Cincinnati Reds today. I thought that my baseball conversation would likely be capped by having Brandon Gaudin on the program. And if you missed it, podcast available now, 1075thefan.com. Brandon, now the new television voice of the Atlanta Braves. I've watched less Reds baseball over the last couple of years. My favorite baseball team now for 40 years, just because I'm to an age, I'm like, listen, if you're not going to be competitive, you're not going to get my attention. You're not going to get my time. But this was pretty cool when the Reds put this out on Twitter about 35 minutes or so ago. They literally showed like all of the headshots of Joey Votto from his time with the organization. You know, the last 15 wearing the number 19, the previous two not having a number, just knowing he was, to use the Colin Cowherd phrase, hot minor league prospect. And when I tell a Joey Votto story, I was fortunate to be on the call of one game of his for the Louisville Bats for the Indianapolis Indians, maybe 06, 07, somewhere in that time. And Joey hit a ball between the 405 and 418 signs at Victory Field that never got more than, say, 15, 20 feet above the ground, and literally was hit so hard as a line drive that when the ball hit center field, the fence, the padded fence, it left a dent in it as it hit it. I'm like, you know what? This kid might have a future. And nearly two decades later, we're still talking about him. And while he's not going to have probably the World Series success of players on the big red machine, you know, you're literally talking about him as like one of the two or three greatest Cincinnati Reds of all time. That's the level of for a team that's been playing for 150 years. That's how good Joey Votto is. All time, he's on the Mount Rushmore. If you're listening, JMB, I know how much you love that comment. You know, you have to get past many fingers of hand number one to talk about how good Joey Votto is. But the reason I bring this up is not really anything about Joey Votto, but it's the symmetry of the uniforms that the Reds have had since that time. Now, you could say that the Reds have had a classic style, and that's fair. Like, the only change in my, you know, like 40 years of Reds fandom was that brief time where they wore the black and red, or the red caps and the black bills, or the milkman look of the early 90s of the white caps. I'm not saying we go back to those, but perhaps it's time for uniform change. If you're showing me 15 years of Joey Votto on social media and the uniform is the damn same for 15 years, and let's face it, this has not been like some classic era of Red success that we're talking about here. There's been like, you know, a couple of playoff appearances. I don't think I've missed anything. Like, the last Reds playoff series win was 1995. Maybe it's time we change the uniforms up a little bit. If Joey Votto has been wearing the same stinking uniform since 2008. And I realize it's non-visual medium, and I'm not a fashion designer. I'm not sure what I would do differently. But maybe, just maybe, we tweak those a little bit if Joey's been in the same uniform style since 2007. Just some fodder for thought on this Friday afternoon. Let's take this quick time out. When we come back, we'll wrap up the phone calls, the tweets, we'll recap the guest, and we'll talk to you, whatever it is you want to talk about. Six great guests yesterday, five of them today, just you and me the rest of the way on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Good morning, sports fans from Indianapolis, Indiana.
This is where heroes become legends, and legends become legendary.
Elio Castroneves joins the four-time winner's club.
This is a special blend of speed.
And more than Jeter, make the fan, they'll win it.
Tradition.
You just don't know what Indy means.
And magic.
Some of us lost it.
This is the Indy 500. But you've never seen this 500. This is May.
Get your tickets now at IMS.com.
Mom, Dad,
Sis?
Here we go again.
Why are you in a suit?
Picture, if you will, a world with the best network imaginable. I'm talking about the Xfinity 10G network.
Go on.
Mom, remember how your reality shows wouldn't load with all of us online? Now you can binge. And Susie, we'll have fast internet in the basement.
Nice.
If you have any questions, here's my card.
This is just your name on a gum wrapper.
Introducing the 10G network only from Xfinity. The future starts now. Now through March 21st, new customers can get 200 megabit Xfinity internet during our limited time Xfinity 10G network launch celebration for just $25 a month for 2 years. Plus, there's no annual contract required and you get Wi-Fi equipment included. Go to Xfinity.com/10G, call 1-800-XFINITY, or visit a store today. Requires paperless billing and auto pay with stored bank account. Restrictions apply. Taxes and fees extra. After promo, regular rates apply to internet service and devices. Actual speeds vary.
Hey guys, looking for a reason to spend 3 days on the couch watching basketball? Schedule your vasectomy at Urology of Indiana for a Thursday or Friday, then sit back, relax, and catch some games over the weekend while you recover. It may be the only time your wife approves of hoarding the couch and the remote control. Vasectomies at Urology of Indiana are simple and typically take only about 15 minutes. Soon after, you'll be out the door and on your way home. During your recovery, you'll take ibuprofen and be back to your normal activities in 3 days. The docs at Urology of Indiana are board certified and perform vasectomies every day of the week, all year long. They're pros at what they do, and they have multiple vasectomy clinics, so chances are good there's one close to you. If you've been putting off your vasectomy, now is the time. You'll never have a better excuse to watch basketball. Call Urology of Indiana or visit vasectomyindy.com for information and to schedule an appointment. That's vasectomyindy.com.
Junior Maddie Nolan can fill it up, but she's one of those playmakers that does a little bit of everything. 22 points a game, almost 6 rebounds, and she is somebody that can hit it from the outside but drive it to the basket. She was the engine that makes this team run and has been playing terrific basketball in postseason play.
6-point lead for Warren Sipple. Three-minute mark.
And get a little screen for Nolan. Let her shoot it.
Can't leave her open. You just cannot leave her open. She's too good. 17 for Maddie Nolan.
I would say go to that well over and over again if they're going to stay in that 2-3 zone.
Those are the voices of Mark Janes and Jane Schott. That is the 4A championship game from 5 years ago, and Maddie Nolan had a fantastic effort and a losing effort for the Eagles as Stacy Mitchell and Warren Central won that state title game by a score of 50-46. Maddie had 17 points. She'd go on to be an Indiana All-Star, and now she is a senior at the University of Michigan. She started every game for a top 15-ranked team, and she's in the top 10 in career three-pointers in Michigan history. The next stars of college basketball, perhaps the WNBA, could be in action tomorrow at Bankers. I'm sorry, 3-2-1. Do that again. Gainbridge Fieldhouse. Good thing I did it on radio, not the television broadcast yesterday or tomorrow. Anyway, 1A game, Lanesville, Bethany Christian. 2A game, Forest Park LaPel. 3A game, Cordon and Fairfield. 4A game, Bedford North Lawrence and Fishers. I got all 8 of those right. The IHSA Girls Basketball State Finals are presented by the Indiana Fever and the Indiana Pacers. I hope to see you at Gainbridge. Yes, that's what it's called. Gainbridge Fieldhouse tomorrow at 10:30.
A girl in Kenya dreams of becoming a doctor. An elder in Guatemala dreams of becoming part of a community. Reach out and change their world, and it will change your own. Unbound.org.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan.
This is how we do it.
I saw Montel Jordan in concert at the artist formerly known as Deer Creek. He was not the headliner. He was part of a three-act show. Pretty sure Boyz II Men was the headliner in the summer of 1995. 6'8", indeed, he stood. Greg Rakestraw is my name, Jimmy Cook on the ones and twos, and Jimmy was kind enough to participate in an Indy 11 Q&A with me about 25 minutes ago. This portion of the program is what you're used to. Jimmy wants to make you some money.
The Jay Cook Plays of the Day.
This is me, all right? I'm not a athlete. This is my way. This is how I win.
Today's plays of the day, we will stay in the NBA. We're going to take the Sacramento Kings +8 as they are in L.A. against the Clippers. Also going to take the Cleveland Cavaliers money line. They are on the road against the Hawks of Atlanta. It's not posted yet, but I assume it'll probably be around 23.5 or so when it is posted. That's just how college basketball betting works in the state of Indiana. I'll take Trace Jackson Davis's over tomorrow for Indiana against Purdue. Those plays on Twitter at the Jay Cook.
Now, is this the part where I get to brag on my picks as well? Can I offer
always,
some picks?
Always.
Well, how about this for very well-timed emails? Obviously, you're familiar with our buddy Alan Karpik of GoldenBlack.com. Yes. For the last 10 years or so, I have been invited to play in something called Media Mania, where every week during the football season, every week during the basketball season, I am asked to pick five games. Myself and 20-ish, 25, 30 media personalities, sponsors, people that know people, etc. And there are weekly winners and there are year-long winners. James, you want to guess who this week's winner of Media Mania that gets dinner at an Arnie's location across the state of Indiana might be?
I'm going to take a guess and say one Greg Rakestraw.
Hey! Got all 15 right. So there's there's five games. Blind squirrels find nuts from time to time. Five games, like the most confident game you have, you put a five on. 4, 3, 2, 1. Now, I was actually leading the season-long competition, and I myself had a Purdue at Maryland and Northwestern week. I think I had five the previous week. Ooh. I stunk out. I was the Baltimore Ravens in October of 2000. Monsters of the Midway for 4 months. God awful for a month. That was me. I have rebounded with a perfect score last week. So with that, would you like to hear my five picks for upcoming college basketball games?
Give it to me.
All right. In order, I'm gonna take this like 1 through 5. Okay. And again, these aren't with the spread. This is straight up, okay? Because we're not playing, we're just playing for pizza. We're going to pick them straight up, okay? Number one, Northwestern will win at Maryland. Write this down, Jimmy. Number two, Rutgers has been a great story. They are off the rails because of an injury. I like Steve Pike and I like the Scarlet Knights a lot, but they've been struggling lately. Give me Penn State to win at home against Rutgers. Game number three is Michigan State and Nebraska. And Michigan State has been, again, on this emotional roller coaster. I've told you the last couple of days, I didn't expect Indiana to actually win at Michigan State on Tuesday, and they didn't. I think Michigan State comes down from that. And frankly, you may not have been paying attention because, frankly, nobody pays attention to Nebraska basketball. But the Huskers have been playing better as of late. They've been picking up some wins. I'm going with hashtag Nebraskaball to beat Michigan State coming up when they play. Now, Purdue's games are always included. My number four pick is for Purdue to win in Madison against Bucky, which has not been easy for Purdue. They've had a little more success there than Indiana has had over the years. But obviously, it was a Wisconsin team that does have kind of a siege and having a great freshman year, but not what they have been. I've got Purdue to win at Wisconsin. And then, for my lock of the week, Purdue beating Indiana at Mackey Arena. The southern half of the state is swearing at me as we speak. And probably a good chunk of the northern half of the state as well. So there you go. Those are my five picks. Sure to go wrong, because once you start bragging about one great week of the picks, it all goes in the tank. By the way, the Media Mania standings for this year kind of look a lot like the middle of the Big Ten. Not a lot of separation between those of us that are... I'm 3 points off from the year long victory. And I think I've never won the year long competition. At least I can't remember if I have. I think I get ownership of the magazine if I win the year long competition. 317-239-1070 is the telephone number, at Greg Rakestraw on Twitter. Email the program to greg@1070thefan.com. In case you missed our guest list today, Brandon Gaudin joined us. Again, of course, Brandon, again, I can't believe it's been 10 years. I literally can hear him. If I think of Brandon calling Butler games, I think of Brandon's call of the Final Four win against VCU in Houston in 2011. I can literally hear him saying the national championship game once more from that night 12 years ago. And I think of the opposite of the reaction of Brad Stevens to the Roosevelt Jones bucket to beat Gonzaga when game day was at Butler in 2013. You remember that night, I was supposed to be there. I mean, you remember this part. I do. I was supposed to be there, and I was sick. I literally called Jim McGrath at 7:30. Jim, I know there's no seats in the house. Jim, the longtime SID since retired at Butler. Jim, I'm not getting off my couch. I don't want my open seat to go to waste. Please have somebody sit there, because I'm sure there's people that are waiting in the media room that actually like to sit and enjoy this game. And that's the game that I missed, was that amazing steal. And Rosie, on the push shot from 15 feet, hits it. And Brad Stevens, being the guy that he is, like, literally, to use a wrestling terminology, no-sold it. Like just literally turned and walked and, like, almost apologized to Mark Few. Like, I'm sorry this crazy play happened and you lost in our building. God bless you and your family. Good night. And, like, walked to the locker room. Well, Brandon, of course, being the play-by-play guy, had the absolute opposite reaction. Always enjoy my conversation with Brandon. I think he's got Butler and Marquette, I think, is his next game. Follow him, and he's been doing the Braves games on TV this year. He's going to do a fantastic job. Jeremiah Johnson, he's got a Friday night off, but he, Chris Sedari, Quinn Buckner, Mark Boyle, the rest of the Pacers traveling crew, they get to spend a Friday night in Orlando because the Pacers play tomorrow night against the Magic. You can hear that here on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Kylen Granson of the Indianapolis Colts joined us. Enjoyed really my first one-on-one conversation with Kylen in a couple of years. He has a book drive that is going on the entire month of March in conjunction with Indianapolis Kroger locations. KG's Kids, KGSKids.com. Has more information. Kylen says he is an obsessive reader. He's the son of an educator. He's trying to raise 10,000 books for kids across central Indiana. So go see him. He's going to be at the Kroger location at 116th and Olio Road next Saturday from 11 to 1. But you can take a book to a Kroger location the entire month of March. Let's get that man 10,000 books for a noble cause. Antoine Davis was phenomenal. He is 97 points away from catching Pistol Pete Maravich as the all-time leading scorer, I believe, in Divisions 1, 2, and 3 of the NCAA. I at the NAIA level, I think there have been players that have scored more points. Like, for example, the late Steve Platt, whom the arena is named after at Huntington University, and their longtime basketball coach, I think he had 3,700-something in his days at Huntington. So that's why I've said, like, the Division I record, and then maybe all three divisions. It's not completely the college basketball record. But if you're in a conversation with Pistol Pete in terms of scoring, you must be pretty good. And again, you can argue what's more impressive. One was 3 years, one's 5 years, one was three-point shot, one was no three-point shot. The fact that someone is even in the conversation with Pistol Pete is amazing. And Mark Lowry, head coach of the Indy 11, also joined the program today. And if you missed that interview, you can go to the podcast page or you can listen to Soccer Saturday tomorrow morning because you're going to hear it again. I'll also be joined by Amanda Vandervoort, who is the commissioner of the W League. The Indy 11 women's team will play their second season. They were great last year. Season 2 for them begins on May 10th. And you'll also hear Chris Doran, If you're in the Bloomington area, you know who Chris is because he lived there for a long time. He does a lot of Big Ten soccer for Big Ten Network, radio voice of the Columbus Crew. He'll be on the show tomorrow as well. Somebody I mentioned on the program has decided to call in. That is my buddy Aaron Pittman. Hello, sir. How are you? I'll try that again, sir, because we were a little slow. And actually, even though you have a deeper voice than me, if we have you potted down on the board, we can't hear you. How are you, Aaron?
Oh, I'm quite well. How are you?
See, now you hear that projection. He's getting full announcer voice speaking into the phone. Yes, my friend, you got a shout-out on the broadcast earlier today.
Hey, I mean, I'll take what I can get. So just unfortunately, I wasn't listening at that point in time, so I missed it. I'll have to go back on the YouTube channel and listen to it.
Absolutely. Other than saying hi, anything else to add to the conversation today?
I literally have nothing unless you want to talk about, we've got 7 minutes left. Maybe we want to talk about the most obnoxious fan bases.
I don't want any part of that. It's a feel good Friday. I don't want that attached to my name. Where are you going to be tonight for your game?
I am off tonight.
That doesn't happen. You got like 39 different, you got more gigs than me. How do you get a night off?
Somehow, some way, every school that I work for is on the road tonight. Ben Davis is at Tech. North Central had a Tuesday night game. Anderson is on the road. So I'm actually taking, my wife and I are taking our 13-month-old daughter to Smiley's over in Castleton and going to let her get all of her energy out before bed. So it's a good tune-up before sectionals next week. I'm looking forward to the tournament and hope my alma mater, Ben Davis, can go deep in the tournament. Hope that North Central can go deep and Anderson as well.
Whose wedding are you playing tomorrow, by the way?
I have no wedding tomorrow. Matter of fact, I am announcing non-sports related. I am announcing a drumline competition out at Decatur Central High School. So I have a long 11-hour day ahead of me tomorrow.
You'll crush it, I'm sure. Thanks for calling, my friend. Appreciate you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
My buddy Aaron Pittman, follow him on social. Virtual Announce is where you can find him. And also a shout-out. You know, the reason I brought Aaron up is that people said, hey, favorite PA announcer, hey, favorite atmosphere, favorite gymnasium, etc. And I said, Aaron's my favorite PA guy. My buddy Chad Nickham is a close second. And Chad will be doing the girls' basketball state finals tomorrow at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. Chad does the Hall of Fame Classic, does a lot of the IHSA state finals at this point, but those are two guys. You hear them in a high school game. Chris Keyes would be in that mix. There's a bunch of stuff with Lawrence Central University, etc. There are a lot of great guys that get behind a microphone, not even from a play-by-play standpoint, but simply from a standpoint of on a public address system. Looks like we have a lot of great coaches and great talent and great gyms. We got good people rocking a microphone as well. Couple of quick things from Twitter before I exit stage left. From CB, what were your five picks again? Apparently, Steve thinks I'm going to make him some money. Just know that these are not legally binding, okay? If you lose money, maybe I'll give you my Arnie's gift card or something like that. Northwestern wins at Maryland. Penn State beats Rutgers. That game's in State College. Nebraska in Lincoln beats Michigan State. Purdue goes on the road and beats Wisconsin. Purdue at home beats the Indiana Hoosiers. And finally, from Jim, you wore me out just by sharing your schedule for the next couple of days. Jim, I would not have it any other way. I get paid to go to ball games for a living. Life's pretty good. And tomorrow morning, I get to be on the call of my hometown, my high school, playing for a state championship. And remarkably, it is the third time I have gotten to do that in the last 8 years. Can't fathom that. I got to go watch him practice and took my mom with me to that practice the other day. That was pretty cool, too. Almost as cool as hanging out with you guys for 3 hours. Thanks for putting up with me. JMB comes up next.